go. Head On with Bob Kincaid. 3 hours of conversation, cussing, and a discussing with America's only born and bred Southern liberal talk host. Head On with Bob Kincaid is brought to you each night by Coal River Mountain Watch. Coal River Mountain Watch invites you to become part of the solution, part of a sustainable future, part of the uprising against mountaintop removal. Coal River Mountain Watch, crmw.net. And now, from high in the hills of beautiful West Bicod, Virginia, here's Bob Kincaid on the Head On Radio Network.
Well, howdy. Well, and happy Robert Burns night to you all. There's that's old cousin Angus Kincaid there. Howdy. It is the 25th day of January 2019, and by Jove, I'm almost in a singing mood. Something just kind of popped into my mind a few minutes before airtime based on what happened earlier today. How's that go? By the way, the fundraising goal is $219. You don't want any more of this. Well, you know. How's it go? What a day this has been. What a rare mood I'm in. I've just seen Donald Trump cave. There's a smile on my face for every federal worker in the place. 'Cause I've just seen Donald Trump cave. I'll be here all weekend. Pass the tip jar around. What a day. Yeah. I mean, it started early. Yeah, when the FBI's banging down your door at 5 a.m., what did one FBI agent say when they were taking down Roger Stone? This one's on us. And, of course, he came out pissing and moaning and spitting and hissing in front of the courthouse in Fort Lauderdale later in the day, telling you, that wasn't necessary. I would have turned myself. Yeah, but see, the problem is the guy you helped get elected president by playing shenanigans with Mother Russia. Well, he had the government shut down, so that meant that there probably wasn't sufficient staff to just hang around the FBI office waiting for you to turn yourself in. And if you waited past, say, February 1st, the court system would have been shut down. So, yeah, it was necessary to do the 5 o'clock knock. 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock, 5 o'clock knock. No, stop. Just stop. Stop, Bob. It's Friday on the front porch for this, like I said, 25th day of January, 2019. This is the Horn HeadOn.live is where you go for the stream. It's where you go to with the PayPal button. It's where you go. There's a Patreon button there. And it's also where you go if you want to click on chat room and pick yourself out a screen name and a password and jump into the merry, wacky, zany, real-time multimedia extravaganza that is the Horn chat that takes place in the 3 hours in which this program is live, Monday through Friday from 6 to 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, 3 to 6 p.m. Pacific. And if you do pick out a screen name and a password, you will be immediately greeted this evening by Anatole and by Darn Tootin and by our buddy Dennis and by Little Thunder and Sailor Chick and Otto DeShot and Squeaky and VT Blom. Got a great group gathered in anticipation of what I expect to be will be a rollicking Friday on the front porch, because it is Friday on the front porch. Now, did I do the "Hi, I'm Bob Kincaid" part? Because I am. Bob Kincaid, not "Hi." We don't do that here on this program. We leave that to Rush Limbaugh. A little bit of a program announcement. Over at the Horn's Facebook page and over at HeadOn.live, you'll find something new, and that is a direct link to the Extraordinary Ordinary Roundtable. That's right. You can just click on it, and you'll be in the Friday on the Front Porch chat conversation. You'll want to make sure that you've got your speakers enabled and you're not feeding back and we're not echoing and all of that stuff. But it's super-duper easy to participate in the conversation. And I invite one and all who are listening live to so do. So try it out. Let's see if it works. And you'll also find there the newly redesigned PayPal interface that includes things like Have a Show on Me and various levels of Kick in 5, Kick in 10, Kick in 20, et cetera, so forth. And then there's Other. Other is there for the various and sundry multimillionaire liberals who might like to actually support independent, progressive, liberal broadcasting. But as it stands, it's all there. It's easy to find. And we've got a $219 fundraising goal on the table this evening. That finishes January. We are $219 behind. It should have, by all accounts, it should have ended last night. But if we can finish it off this evening, then that means we've got fundraising free radio all of next week, all the way up till Friday, which is the first day of February. Okay. Yeah, that's true. That's true. Sparky reminding me, you have to have Skype to get into the conversation. If you want to use that little linky there at the Horn page or on the headon.live website, that's absolutely true. It doesn't work without Skype, because that's where we hold the extraordinary, ordinary roundtable in the old hollow tree that we sublet from the Keebler elves and at whose head Sparky sits. Okay? And by the way, yeah, you will be capably moderated in the chat room this evening by longtime, inveterate, indefatigable veteran chat room moderator Sparky, as well as pinch hit midweek utility chat room moderator and all around great guy Steve from Georgia Stan. All right, that seems to be most of the housekeeping. And that would indicate that, well, we can get into the meat of the program. If you want to help knock down that, and by the way, where the fundraising goal is concerned, last night, Charlene on Rogues Island, who, by the way, is a charter member of the sorority of Leans and a sister of the Tracy's Rocks with Queen Tracy. Queen Tracy is on the way, probably there by now. In Las Vegas. Good luck to you. May the odds be ever in your favor, Tracy. Yeah, just checking some messages here. Yeah. All right. By the way, Ralph's getting us started early. I'll kick in that $19 if somebody will kick in $20 or the equivalent. Thank you. Thank you, Ralph, because Charlene's challenge was predicated on bringing in another 50. On bringing in 100. We brought in 50 last night. There's 50 to go. So if somebody will meet Ralph's challenge, that'll take us to Ralph's needs somebody to kick in 20. Ralph's will then kick in 19. That's 39. That leaves us 11 to finish Charlene's challenge. So that's where we stand this evening. Okay. What a day. What a day. You know, as we were talking last night, we discussed the fact that there was every likelihood, based on that, on the fact that the Mueller grand jury had met yesterday, which is kind of unusual. The last time they met on a Thursday, they handed down a boatload of indictments against a bunch of Russian witches, because it is, after all, a witch hunt. Julius Geezer reminded us that, again today, that it's a witch hunt. Where is it? Let me... Yeah, we'll find it. He melted down a little bit today.
Greatest witch hunt in the history of our country.
Greatest witch and hunt are all have capital letters. And then history is capitalized and country is capitalized. Julius Geezer tweets like an AI bot that hasn't quite figured out that whole rules of art of knowing words thing just yet. But apparently, Julius Geezer did not like the fact that the press, the Fourth Estate, the only profession that's mentioned in the Constitution, it just happened to be there when the FBI showed up to politely ask Roger Stone if he would mind going on a little road trip with him. By now, I'm sure you're well familiar with it, but doggone it, the Schadenfreude demands that we run it again.
Senator Kamala.
Oh, damned ads. CNN was there. This is their ad.
This is CNN breaking news.
Breaking news this morning, the FBI has arrested Roger Stone, the president's political advisor. Exclusive footage you're looking at right now from CNN as the FBI arrives at Roger Stone's residence in Fort Lauderdale, Florida, taking him into custody. We understand he will be arraigned in Fort Lauderdale later this morning, indicted on 7 counts, 1 count of obstruction, 5 counts of making false statements, 1 count of witness tampering. Again, they arrived before dawn there, before 6 a.m., or just after 6 a.m. A dozen officers were told. The FBI agent shouted, FBI warrant. And you can see it all play out right here.
This is just remarkable. It's just remarkable to watch, you know, what they call... Okay, that's it. FBI, open the door. And now they're about to say another warning. FBI warrant. This is called...
Yeah, we probably could have heard him say that if she hadn't been talking. Oddly enough, though, at the same time this was going on, because here at the Horn, we curate only the finest wing nuttery for your edification and Schadenfreude needs. At the same time that was going on, well, Alex Jones was on the phone with Roger Stone. Rhymes, doesn't it? Yeah, how about that? Yeah, hold on here. Works a lot better when, yeah, right, when I actually punch the right button. I'm a little punch-y today, I'm afraid. I didn't start celebrating Burns Night early or anything, but here we go.
They didn't break into it and cut it off. We've had a lot of that go on. I mean, my phone all the time starts dialing people and going places and doing things. It's insane. It's absolutely insane.
Alex Jones's phone goes places. Presumably, since he's making it sound like it's weird, without him. Man, Alex, I'd lay off that chocolate chicken bone paleo beverage if I were you, buddy. It appears to be rotting your brain. What little of it there ever was.
Shane. Okay, Roger is back. Roger, your phone dropped. Roger, the whole world's watching and listening right now. What do you want to tell the world about what's happening with your fake indictment?
Well, first of all, actually...
fake indictment. You know, from the fake grand jury. Served by the fake FBI agents and arraigned by the fake judge. And so it was that video footage from 6 o'clock this morning that got Julius Geezer rather wrought.
And greatest witch hunt in the history of our country. No collusion. Border coyotes, drug dealers, and human traffickers are treated better. Who alerted CNN to be there?
That's what he's worried about. No, what he's worried about is that Roger Stone is going to roll on him like a little red wagon. Now, Roger Stone has said he never will. But there is a strange and mysterious coercive power to the idea of having a septuagenarian rat fucker spending the rest of his natural born life behind bars. And with seven counts, if they were to be served, say, consecutively and not cumulatively upon conviction on all of them, which is pretty much a lead pipe cinch, seeing as how it's all based on documentary evidence and recordings of his statements to, say, the House Intelligence Committee. Yeah, he can bluster and blow, but eventually he'll probably roll. You know, just like Paul Manafort rolled. Just like Michael Cohen rolled. Now, in government parlance, they prefer to use terms like cooperated. And that's all well and good, but if you went and read the indictments today, I did, you get, and this is another one of those classic Mueller indictments that reads like a Mickey Spillane novel. There's a lot of stuff out there to suggest that this is going to continue to go higher. Oh, maybe not next Friday or the Friday after that, but this is going to continue to climb. This is like ivy that's gotten out of control. Poison ivy. And but wait a minute, let's hear from Roger Stone.
You wouldn't believe the scene I'm looking at outside. There must be 500-600 reporters out there. But we're exclusive here at InfoWars. I predicted for many months that I would be framed on some process charge, that they would find no evidence of Russian collusion or WikiLeaks collaboration.
Except for the fact that it's that exact contact with WikiLeaks, Organization One, and the head of WikiLeaks, whose address is given as being the Ecuadorian embassy in London, that narrows things down considerable, like, that, I don't know, maybe if your mind is addled by paleo chocolate chicken bone nutritional beverage, you might believe some of this crap, but otherwise, it's really sort of pitiful and pathetic if it was anybody but, well, an inveterate lifelong rat fucker like Roger Stone.
They would take things that are clearly activities on my part, which are covered by the First Amendment, and try to criminalize them, in essence, criminalizing political activity. What people need to understand is that I am innocent, that the whole Russian collusion investigation is...
Yeah, he's innocent. As a newborn baby rat.
A distraction from the real crimes of the Clintons and the Obamas. But I need people's help more than ever. If they want me to fight, and I intend to fight, to clear my name against the...
Now, this is the fun part, because this is where he puts on the hustle to the people who tune into InfoWars. But it's not something that Alex Jones is really down with. That's not why I had him on.
These politically motivated charges and these politically motivated prosecutors, I need folks to go to stonedefensefund.com. This is going to be, you know, they project my legal costs to be $2 million. But I intend to fight. I need every patriot to stand with me.
And, Roger, I want to be very clear about this.
Yep. Okay. What? Tell us, clarify it for us there, Alex.
BuzzFeed gets $300 million a year and doesn't have the traffic of InfoWars with our combined network.
Well, that's because they're not selling chocolate paleo chicken bone nutritional beverage.
We sell $40, $50 million of product, but it's literally marked down to half cost.
There's some expensive paleo chocolate chicken bones.
So then that's gross $20 million.
Oh, it's past gross, Alex. It's disgusting. So here's Roger Stone pleading for his very existence. And what's Alex? Well, it's turning into a pitch for Alex Jones.
Well, no, gross 40. Then when he keeps 20, then you hire all the crew, pay all the services, pay for the bandwidth, do everything. I'm left with a couple million, and then it literally all goes to lawyers. And so InfoWars needs to be supported. Everyone needs to double down and go buy the products. BuzzFeed gets $300 million pure cash and still loses $100 million a year and just laid off 15%. They're cutting us off because we're popular, because we tell the truth, because we...
No, you're being cut off because you're a purveyor of hate, you fuck. You're being run off of platforms because you do things like participate in promulgating the Pizzagate conspiracy. Oh, by the way, overnight, somebody tried to set fire to Comet Ping Pong Pizza in Washington, D.C. I'm guessing it wasn't Hillary Clinton or John Podesta. They found some matches. They found some charcoal lighter fluid. And the guy, whoever it was a guy, he tried to set a curtain on fire. They found it. They hit it with the fire extinguishers. No one was injured. But how very, very interesting that would happen when, you know, that happened.
We're growing and expanding. Now we're to the point of contracting. So, yes, InfoWarsStore.com, InfoWarsLife.com, go get products. And yes, Roger, people need to commit now.
To InfoWars. You got to wonder how Roger felt about having his grift run over top of by Alex Jones's grift. Oh, if only Horn Nutraceuticals had taken off the way I hoped it would. You'd think that those sex clams really would have gone somewhere, but doggone it, it just didn't. But this was by no means the end of the morning. By the time that the news cycle is really cruising, we find out that, lo and behold, FAA staffing was so shorthanded at LaGuardia that flights were being diverted to Philadelphia. Then we found out that they were shorthanded in Philadelphia and flights were being diverted there. At one point in time, there were just no landings allowed at LaGuardia. And then there began to be rumblings of a general strike against the shutdown. Private sector unions, like the flight attendants, saying, screw it, let's all walk. And so by around 2:30 this afternoon, things had reached what I guess we can only describe as an intolerable level of pressure. And that was, and by that time, of course, Roger Stone had already appeared at the courthouse in Fort Lauderdale, and then, of course, he had to come out and make a statement.
Nothing to hide. He has nothing to hide.
This is his lawyer wearing a bow tie and a jacket from approximately 1857, but let's continue.
He's spoken before, and he'll speak to you now. Roger?
Congratulations, Roger.
Thank you. As I have always said, the only thing worse than being talked about is not being talked about.
And the rat fucker ripped off Oliver Wilde. He hasn't always said that. He's quoting Oliver Wilde. Isn't he? Yeah.
After a two-year inquisition, the charges today relate in no way to Russian collusion, collaboration, or any other...
Except it's all laid out in the indictment, and it has everything in the world to do with Russian collusion. Or footsie, if you prefer that complicated legal term. Or conspiracy. I mean, the charges are obstruction of justice, witness tampering, because he threatened to do in a guy's dog. I mean, that's the level of class we're talking about here. And this is one of the values of Mueller's so-called talking indictments. They give you what they know so that you don't have to wait around for disclosure of, say, an email in which he threatens to kill a witness. You know, nobody hacked his email. Guccifer 2.0 didn't send the email. Roger Stone sent the email in which he threatened, I'll take that little dog away from you. But the crowd was having none of it.
Illegal act in connection with the 2016 campaign. I am falsely accused of making false statements during my testimony to the House Intelligence Committee. That is...
Yeah, then the chant starts. You hear it? Lock him up. Lock him up.
Incorrect. Any error I made in my testimony would be both immaterial and without intent. I find it disturbing that the special counsel's office released a press release prior to informing my attorneys that I would be charged today. This morning, at the crack of dawn.
And now we move into the heartbroken pissing and moaning about the fact that he happened to get arrested in the early morning hours because the FBI agents who had to arrest him are working without pay, and for all we know, needed to get to second jobs so that they could pay their rent or something like that. Or maybe go down to the food bank and stand in a bread line like it's the Soviet Union in 1974. Here's the fun thing. The guy with the funny 1857 coat with the weird velvet collar, that's his lawyer. And he's just sitting there, standing there, letting Roger Stone run off at the mouth and essentially give his not particularly compelling defense to the media. And the crowd around him, of course, chanting, lock him up. This is a pretty good indication of how that defense is going to play with a jury. A jury is not going to pull out the lace hankies and blow their noses because of the fact that this rat fucker got taken out in... You know what? You know those pounds on the door? Open up, FBI, open up, warrant. If Roger Stone was anything but an old, nasty white man, they would have just gotten out the battering ram, battered down the door, and gone about their business, because that's ordinarily how they operate. So even cloaked in all the majesty that white privilege can offer, Roger Stone is still an aggrieved little pissant. What's that, Darlene in Connecticut? Just wondering, could this morning's arrest and indictment have also prompted Trump's willingness to agree with Congress to temporarily end the partial government shutdown this afternoon in order to divert attention from Stone? Well, just a minute. Precisely. Which leads one to ask the question, how bad off do you have to be that the only way of diverting attention from your own felonious guilty conscience is to give in and get your ass handed to you by Nancy Pelosi? Because that's what happened. He got backed into a corner, and along the way, somebody stuck a microphone in Press Secretary Jethreen Bodine's face, Sarah Sandbag, Huxterby, whatever. and asked her for a reaction. Well, this has absolutely nothing to do with the White House. It ain't got nothing. No, it's got everything to do with how you got your front feet in the trough in the White House, there, Jethreen. Yeah, at one point in time, some reporter asked her. Let's see. Did the president direct someone to have Roger Stone reach out to WikiLeaks? At which point, Jethreen Bodine, the press secretary, said,
I'm not an attorney.
Now, this is one of those moments where if it happened in a courtroom, Matlock or Perry Mason would leap from his seat and say, I object, Your Honor. The witness is being non-responsive. Because, again, when you give an answer to the question that has nothing to do with the question that was asked, namely, did the president direct someone to have Roger Stone reach out to WikiLeaks, and your answer is,
I'm not an attorney.
Well, your answer may just as well have been, I'm not a brain surgeon, or I'm not a fry cook. I think we're going to be sticking with the Jethreen Bodine imagery for Sarah Hasselbeck sandbags for a little while now. But that's exactly what it was, Darlene. His only alternative, that he is so far back in a corner of his own painting that his only alternative was surrender. Although he tried desperately to make it not sound like surrender. Even if it was. Now, that was interesting. And this is a video moment, so pardon the dancing about architecture. But they get him dressed, and it took the better part of the day to get the dosage right. This was probably a bad morning in the White House. You try the Haldol, it doesn't work. You try the Depakote, nothing happening. He's still madder than a hatter and chewing on the furniture like a little baby beaver. But they finally got they reach around him with a little spoon and shove a little Adderall up his nose, and he finally begins to come around a little bit. But there's a moment in this video. At the beginning of the video, where he's walking and he has to go down a couple of steps. Like one. And he is hanging his head and watching each step that he takes. Because to go back to some of the things that we've talked about in the past, he's not real steady on his pins these days. And he's mortally afraid of falling. The septuagenarian orange man baby. And so while you hear that, tepid applause for him, well, that whole time he's got his head down, watching one foot go in front of the other, because you get the idea he's not feeling real stable. This is not a well man. And so you get this. He doesn't look up until he's done with like four steps. That's it.
Thank you very much, my fellow Americans. I am very proud to announce today that we have reached a deal to end the shutdown and reopen the federal government.
Now, Roger Stone is part of why he reaches this deal. Another part of it is the business with the fact that airplanes couldn't land. That might have occasioned a few calls from a few airline CEOs. Yeah. And then there was the story about the luncheon that the Republican senators had yesterday, which was something less than a pleasant afternoon's repast. It got so bad that Ron Johnson, who comes from Wisconsin, he works in the lumber mill there. All the people he meets when he walks down the street, they say, "Hey, what's your name?" And he says, "My name is Ron Johnson. I'm a senator from Wisconsin. I work in the lumber mill there." Ron Johnson went after chinless Mitch McConnell. And he said, "This is all your fault." At which point, chinless Mitch turned around and, being a turtle, snapped back and said, "You think I enjoy this, sir?" Desperately casting about, trying to find a white glove with which to slap Ron Johnson across the cheeks and challenge him to meet him the following morning on the field of ornery. And so that was part of it. Because the Republicans in the Senate were beginning to cave. And with 20 of them up for re-election in 2020, 20 and 20, this was making their lives harder than they already knew it was going to be, and they already knew it was going to be hard. Now, let's see here. Let's try a different browser. Because we've talked about this in the past, but there are scads of senators up for re-election. Ron Johnson isn't even one of them. But even he is feeling the heat because of the turnaround that they experienced in 2018 in the midterms. VT Blom in the chat room says, "Bob, I think the NFL gave him a call when LGA got shut down. They don't want to lose Super Bowl Sunday." It may be, but by the same token, remember, Julius Geezer is feuding with the NFL. Ultimately, it turned into a perfect storm. He had to do something to get Roger Stone out of the damn news cycle. And in particular, ooh, that's a hell of an observation. Monique saying, how long till he comes out in full military regalia? He really is looking like Gaddafi towards his last days. No, I won't be making any mention of what Hillary said about that. But he had to get Roger Stone out of the news cycle, and he was failing. And the fact that we were looking at possibly a nationwide labor action, because even with all the strictures that Taft-Hartley places upon labor in this country, when presidents of unions start talking about a general walkout, you know, the flight attendants go, and then the pilots go, and then the mechanics go, and the baggage handlers go, and then who knows, maybe the Teamsters go, and the next thing you know, you've got something that Republicans live in mortal fear of, and generally have been successful in preventing. As Marty says, airplanes couldn't land. There were calls for the entire TSA group assigned to Hartsfield International Airport calling in sick the day after the Super Bowl. And so we found out what kind of a deal maker Julius Geezer really is. A terrible one. He folded like a cheap Trump suit, sopping wet from some sweatshop in China with a 9-year-old chained to the table sewing it. He collapsed. And the White Wing is furious with him. People mumbling about how it's the end of his presidency. About how Nancy Pelosi owned him. By the way, note to all those people who say, oh, we can't, Nancy Pelosi, Bruga Bruga, Speaker of the House, Bruga Bruga, new blood, Bruga Bruga. Anybody out there think anybody but Nancy Pelosi could have owned Donald Trump the way she did? And she didn't just tell him, no, you're not getting, because see, the government's going to open for 3 weeks, and he didn't get a goddamn nickel for his dumbass, stupid, ignorant boondoggle of a wall. And so he resorted to the same thing he resorted to last time. Threats. Well, we'll reopen the government for 3 weeks. But after that, I'll declare a national emergency. Tepid. I mean, that's...
As everyone knows, I have...
That's the very definition of tepid applause. Clap, you fuckers!
A very powerful alternative, but I didn't want to use it at this time. Hopefully it will be unnecessary. I want to thank all of the incredible federal workers and their amazing families who have...
You mean the ones who you told yesterday to go and put their groceries on credit and just tell the grocery store you'd pay them later? The cadences, and this is because I'm involved in the talking business, the cadences of his speech are so weird. The emphases he places on the various wrong syllables are grating and jarring and indicative of a brain that's not working particularly well at all. I mean, just listen to that.
Hopefully it will be unnecessary. I want to thank all of the incredible federal workers and their amazing families who have shown such extraordinary devotion in the face of this recent hardship. You are fantastic people. You are incredible patriots. Many of you have suffered far greater than anyone but your families would know or understand. And not only did you not complain, but in many cases you encouraged me to keep going because you care so much about...
Name one.
About our country and about its border security.
Border security. Not border security. Border security.
Again, I thank you.
There was a sniff there, too, by the way. Did you notice that?
All Americans, I thank you. If we don't get a fair deal from Congress, the government will either shut down on February 15th again, or I will use the powers afforded to me under the laws and
the laws, just generally the laws. You know, maybe the, oh, I don't know, the Hammurabi Code or the Code of Justinian or the Ten Commandments or the 12 Tables. Or there's got to be a law out there somewhere that'll let him build a big stupid wall. See?
The Constitution of the United States to address this emergency. We will have great security.
There was another sniff after security. Yeah, they had to They had to get some Adderall in him in order to get him out the door. It's a terrible thing to have a president who's a freaking speed freak. Peed skills, man. I'm telling you, peed skills. Shit ain't good for you. But he was basically repeating the same threats that everybody now knows are hollow. And if he is stupid enough to declare a national emergency over something that isn't an emergency, his fat orange ass will get kicked all over the court system. Granted, eventually he might prevail, thanks to having Ann's boy Neil and Brat Kavanaugh on the Supreme Court. But it is clear to everyone with an IQ above freezing in this country that Donald Trump, to use an analogy from his favorite form of media, professional wrestling, Donald Trump is severely overmatched, and there's no way you can prepare a script in which he can credibly be said to win the match. No, not at this point. Uh-uh. Sorry. So yeah, it's been a whale of a day. Pardon the noise. Changing out the tank on the heater. It's a little brisk in here. A little brisk outside, yeah, about 30 degrees. Got it up to about 60 in here, which is not intolerable. But it starts getting intolerable the minute it goes out. Michael in Madison, the art of the cave. With a graphic. Trump, the art of the cave. Number one national embarrassment. You wonder why he persists. He's slowly losing the Senate. He's already lost the House. If people are staying away from him in droves inside his own regime... But one last warning, because I am, after all, Bob Kincaid, a little ray of fucking sunshine. So the new drop-dead date is February 15th. Until such time as we get a continuing resolution that just funds the government and gets on with it, and he realizes he's not going to get the wall that Roger Stone invented in the first place. Well, let me back up and say, I'm happy to say that I was wrong about this thing going on until September the 30th. I am not, however, fully convinced that we may not yet see a complete government shutdown come September 30th, however. But God Almighty, it's not even Groundhog Day, and I've already blown through the summer and wasted it. I'm not going to do that. But our joy should be measured by the fact that people who were furloughed, who were stiffed, they're not going to get all their back pay right off the bat. They work 3 weeks without a check. They're going to get 1 week's worth by way of recompense, which means federal employees still stay in a precarious position. What's this? Monique says nobody in his family lives. If he wasn't such an evil bastard, I might feel sorry for him, but he is, so I don't. I think Monique meant to include a number in there, but maybe she was typing kind of fast. As Darlene points out, Roger Stone is weird. Idolatry of Richard Nixon is perplexing. I'm beginning to wonder if Stone actually thinks he is Nixon. Trump and everyone closely involved or associated with him in the past and now all seem to be a bit cracked. P.S. on a side note, been wanting to mention that I got a really weird sense or impression when watching a documentary some months back on Trump that Roy Cohn and Joe McCarthy may have had a thing going. No hard evidence, just a weird feeling. And the way Cohn looked at McCarthy in some of the old film footage in the documentary. Interesting you would mention Roy Cohn, because Roy Cohn is how Donald Trump originally meets Roger Stone. Ta-da! And Roy Cohn comes into the Trump's life when the Trumps, Fred and Donald, get busted for being racists in their landlord practices. So how about that? And then, of course, Roy Cohn dies of HIV. And we've talked a long time about Donald Trump and the spirochetes. Now, Trump was running with a guy who was so flagrant in his unsafe sexual practices that he got a disease that killed him. I'm still not necessarily giving up on the whole spirochetes theory. And by the way, a note coming in earlier today from our buddy Matt in San Francisco. Help me find 45's America. Bob, can you and your vast research staff that work out in the hangar next to the Gulfstream 5 help me find the America where I can get groceries and work with the store about paying it at some later date? I also have furloughed friends that would love to know the banks and landlords that have known them for years and are working with them when they can't pay the rent. Today's news also has me scratching my head. Roger Stone, an older gay man with a larger-than-life-size tattoo of Nixon on his back, is arrested. A guy who knows he's going to end up in jail someday, who wants to deter rear entry, should have a Reagan tattoo. After all, Reagan's inaction regarding AIDS killed more of us than any other president in my lifetime and is a guaranteed boner killer. I always assume Stone is a bottom. I mean, the suits alone scream, "Take me, Vanjie!" Am I doing that right, Matt? It's not easy living inside my brain, Matt says. However, the day when Roger Stone shows up in a prison-issued orange jumpsuit, I'll be pushing that Have a Show on Me button. Thank you, Matt. You just gave me... You know what? The image of a Ronald Reagan tattoo works on heteros, too, apparently. Because, well, and I have a feeling Agnes is suffering a full body shudder there in the next room. And Todd... 2:31 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, the mentally ill fascist traitor appears to be, as I write, as high as a helium-filled kite. What do you think? My default is now that they have to medicate him like a character out of a fucking Hunter S. Thompson book just to get his shoelaces tied now. So, that. And Darlene points out, you're right about emphasis and inflections in Trump's voice. When he said, great security, it sounds like he's really about to say, great sex. We are 54 minutes into the program, and the horn locomotive just took the siding off into the gutter. You know, I was thinking, I'm not supposed to, but I was thinking, since this is Burns night, that I might toss back a wee dram. But with the mental images I'm dealing with now, I think it just turned into a wee liter. Yeah, you understand, of course. Yeah, Arnold says the same thing. I was hungry, Bob. Now not so much. Trump's turned into the... Wait a minute. Arnold says, Trump's turned into the chick from Pulp Fiction. I don't want to see the dancing. No dancing. Ah, okay. Well, we got a clarification on Monique's notes. Nobody in his family cares. If he wasn't such an evil bastard, I might feel sorry for him, but he is. And I add, so she doesn't. There it is. Bleach, says Matt. You must have it by the bucketful. We keep it handy, and we get a bargain down to the Wiggling Pig when you buy it by the case. That Wiggling Pig brand, of course. So here we are. As Brother Deacon Asa says, ah, yes, Donald Trump, that master of malapropisms. So we've made it an hour through the program. Remember, we came into the program with a $219 fundraising goal. Thanks to the challenge from Charlene, there's another challenge on the table, courtesy of Ralphs. Ralphs will put up 19 if somebody will put up 20. And then that'll leave us with $11 to finish Charlene's challenge. And then we'll be able to move toward finishing off fundraising for the month of January so we can have fundraising free radio all of next week. At this point in time, I'm... There we go. It's time to connect to the extraordinary, ordinary roundtable and see where the conversation will take us this evening. What's that, Marty? Just a liter? Let's have a gigaliter of rum. It's Baron's Night, Marty. You don't drink rum on Baron's Night. Commemorating the life and times of Robbie Barons. You drink Scots whiskey. You can drink rum the other 364 days of the year. Oh. What's that, Flavio? Oh, wait a minute. This is a good one. Pursuant to Cardi B, Nancy P dog-walked Trump. Yes, she did. She damned well did. And what a lovely day it was. Oh, wait, that's Irish, not Scots. All right, then, let's run over and check in with Sparky over in the extraordinary around the extraordinary ordinary round table in the old hollow tree that we sublet from the Keebler Elves. Hey, Sparky. Okay, I got the right... yeah, that's up. That's supposed to be... Mm-hmm. Anybody?
I'm here.
Ah, can you hear me? I hear somebody.
How's it going, Bob?
Ah, pretty good. Is that you, Dennis?
Absolutely.
Good deal. Yeah, we're just, I guess, trying out this whole new means of connection thing, so...
Hello, Bob.
Ah, there we go.
This is Steve.
Hey, Steve.
Duncan and I have been accused of sounding alike, but yeah, this isn't him.
No, I don't have any problem. No, you don't sound alike to me, so.
Yeah. Okay, cool. He's got that radio deep baritone voice, you know, very distinguishable.
Mm-hmm.
But he must be feeding Grady or something.
Okay, so like.
He said he's having problems.
Are we kind of worn out with just how damn busy the day's been?
Oh, my God. I don't know if you got my Rube alert at 7 a.m. this morning or not.
But yeah, I did. I saw that. And I, you know, I don't work your corner, man. I mean, if you tell me they're losing their minds on Washington Journal, I wait for the report. I don't.
Oh, I can't even watch that anymore. Oh, my God.
Is that Sailor?
Can you hear me now?
Yeah. Oh, there's Sparky. Yeah,
I'm out. There's Duncan. Let's get back to order.
I couldn't hear you for some reason. I had to unplug my dongle or my Bluetooth thing or whatever a couple of times to put it back in.
Well, it's always a lovely day when the White Wing turns on their God Emperor. Mike Cernovich, the guy who put Pizzagate on the map, he declared. Trump is a broken man. It's over for him. Nancy Pelosi is an alpha. Okay, we got some echoing going on somewhere.
Yeah, mute.
Back feed.
Okay, hang on.
Ooh, and Ann Coulter turned on him.
Good news for George Herbert Walker Bush. As of today, he's no longer the biggest wimp ever to serve as President of the United States.
It was beautiful. Awesome day. Nice outside.
Program note, she's going to be on Bill Maher's tonight, which airs after your show, Bob. So if anybody wants to watch that, it ought to be damn entertaining.
Maybe he'll be sedated and in bed by then.
Hey, Bob, can you hear me?
Yeah, I got you, Sparky.
Could you tell people not to call me because I can't do anything to get them into the chat? They have to use the link on the webpage.
Okay, so the breadcrumb trail is no longer functional. You have to use the Skype link with your Skype that's over on the webpage at headon.live and is also posted at the Horn webpage on Facebook. Right?
Right. Somebody was trying. Clarity was trying to call me. I can't answer the phone when he's in the group.
I'll keep posting in the chat room if that helps.
Yeah. So Clarity, if you'll run over to headon.live, then just click the link. Clarity, there. Run over to headon.live, then just click the link. Okay. So who's got me coming back at me?
Not me. I'm doubly muted.
Okay. We're working out some kinks.
I zapped him, I think.
Oh, that might have been auto to shot.
I don't know. It wasn't because I have him. No, I have.
He said he was turning in about 10 minutes ago. So I don't think it was him, Bob.
It sounded like a woman voice.
Sailor chick's still here though, right?
Yeah, I'm here.
Okay, so, yeah.
I don't hear an echo now either.
Excellent. You sound great. Everybody does now. I think Duncan got rid of it. Thank you, sir.
Well, I had to eliminate him because it wasn't muted. I couldn't mute him either for some reason.
Oh, God, you're going to have to be wandering all over the place looking for the controls, aren't you?
Well, I can see that Steve's muted right now, and I can mute other people.
Yeah, I can see that Steve's muted, and
it works for other people too. Sailor chick, I just muted you. Clarity didn't get the message. But he's still trying to call me.
Okay, let me message her myself and see what see if I can do any good that way.
I can't see my contacts when I'm doing this. That's what.
Yeah, it's weird. They took something perfectly serviceable, and it being Microsoft, they made a mess out of it.
We are experiencing technical difficulties. Please stand by. Bob, play some elevator music.
But other than that, I can tell you, at the base of the old hollow tree out in the pasture today.
Yes.
Was a beautiful little fox.
Oh, how cool.
out there laying in the grass, scratching and carrying on. I got a picture of him, but as everything gets screwed up more, I couldn't get a way to get it so I could put it in this chat. It's on the other computer now. And then the battery died in the camera, so I just said, screw it, and I came back out of here.
So,
want to hear about my road trip?
Yeah, do please.
Well, Tuesday, I went on a 110-mile drive to Susanville through the mountains. And I want to tell you, the snow scenes that I saw, just calendar perfect.
Is that eastward?
Yeah, and the backside of Lassen was just awesome.
So does that bode well for the coming dry season?
It's happening again.
Yeah.
That same person, Live 65, jumped back in, so I don't know if that's corporate or not.
Oh, okay.
They're gone now.
Yeah, well, I just clicked it again because it's not muting, and I can't mute him for some reason. Other people, I can.
And I don't have any idea who that is. Not a clue.
It's probably somebody that just used the link.
Somebody new to Skype or something.
All right, so I hit the stone thing. I got the airline, and I really think the airline thing more than the stone thing is what pushed him over the edge. Because those would be some very angry CEOs to have calling you. Anything else out there going on today?
Just the weather.
Well, no, there was one thing. I noticed it last night after the program was over. You may have seen a story last week about United Airline passengers who were on their way from Chicago to London, and they had to make an emergency landing in Goose Bay, Canada, which apparently is way the hell and gone somewhere, way Canada.
Labrador.
Yeah.
It's a military base.
Well, it turns out that...
That was the true bumfuck Egypt that we called in the Air Force.
Well, it turned out that they were kind of double-secret probation-y about it, but a guy has filed a lawsuit against United. It turns out that that plane had to divert and make an emergency landing, and those people had to wait in the plane for 8 hours, no food, no nothing, because the windshield of the aircraft, it's three layers thick, but the windshield up there where the pilot is, shattered. And the only way they kept the third layer of windshield from breaking and just sucking the pilots out of the plane at 40,000 feet was the co-pilot literally braced the windshield with his back. And along the way, the plane plummeted from 40,000 feet all the way until they managed to get it landed at Goose Bay. And the guy who filed the suit just went up and had a little chit-chat with the pilots and said, what, did you hit a bird or something? And the pilot said, nothing lives at 40,000 feet. And suggested that the mechanic had over-torqued the bolts on the windshield. This apparently makes a difference. But that got me to thinking last night, if the shutdown had continued, well, are there people out there whose job it is, as you know, airline regulators, to make sure that people are torquing the bolts correctly and whatnot? Or maybe it was some guy who had been on the job for 10 or 12 hours, and you don't know. Or maybe it's just accidents happen. But that was a sobering little story. Because that would have been one of those aircraft disasters where, you know, everybody on board dies.
I saw a story that the FAA inspectors weren't working.
Well, that's the other thing. If the plane had gone down, the NTSB, the National Transportation Safety Board, would not have been able to investigate because, you know, they've been furloughed.
No, the guys that are in the maintenance hangars that inspect the work.
Yeah, them too. So they're,
you got to keep a real good record, maintenance records on every aircraft.
So there is somebody who checks that work.
Yeah.
So that could actually have been the reason that happened.
Yeah, it was furloughed.
Jesus. That's sobering. Oh, and big thanks to Darlene from the Sorority of Leans. Darlene just met Ralph's challenge. So that means we are $11 away from finishing off the last of Charlene's challenge, also the Sorority of Leans, so that we can hopefully finish things up this evening. I was hoping to have a fundraising free Friday on the front porch, but it doesn't always play that way. But thank you, Darlene, and thank you, Ralphs. As for the rest of this stuff, I think it's going to, this is the tip of the iceberg. Just the tip. And it probably does require significant medication just to keep Geezer disgust us from tearing off all his clothes and running out and playing with himself in public. But one of the more interesting stories that comes out as a result of all this via Forbes, it appears that the life support system for a haircut, Sean Hannity, was taking his orders. From Roger Stone and Donald Trump. Kurt Eichenwald over on Twitter said that in examining the indictment, as it talks about WikiLeaks' ongoing plan to keep trying to damage Hillary Clinton with email leaks, part of it was to manipulate the media into thinking that Hillary was gravely ill. And whoever it was that was connecting Stone to WikiLeaks said, would not hurt to start suggesting HRC old, memory bad, has stroke, neither he nor she well. I expect it much of next dump focus. And shortly after that email went out, lo and behold, the Hannity job starts banging away on Hillary's health. And among other things, alluded that she was prone to having seizures or some sort of neurological. I mean, I remember all this. They were blathering on about her having Parkinson's. Jesus, this thing's going to touch everything, isn't it? It already has. And quite possibly the funniest result of all this is another motivating factor for him to cave in and fold like a cheap suit was for the purpose of finally getting to deliver the State of the Union, because he has to have the clapping. He's fucking Tinkerbell. If he doesn't get clapped for, he might not make it. And so he thought that by caving in, she'd let him do the State of the Union, but earlier today, Speaker Pelosi issued a statement saying, well, no, I said we'd talk about when to have the State of the Union when the government was reopened. I meant what I said. And so she dog-walked him again. What do you want to bet we're going to have an interesting weekend of tweeting? You guys got to stop being so quiet. This is turning into a filibuster. That's that.
Rock on, Bob.
Yeah, that's dead air, Steve.
I know. It's a radio killer. Duncan and I are trying to figure out. There's still a faint echo loop, and we may just have to live with it. You know.
It's not coming back at me, so it's not going out to the broadcast.
Okay, perfect. But I'll pick it up. Somebody just.
Well, no, you sent me the Rube alert. What was going on?
Oh, my God, the Rubes are going crazy. They were still trying to rationalize. They were making statements like, we had to deal with Obama, so you guys are just going to have to deal with Trump. And they were calling in on all three lines. They'd call in on the left line and say, I couldn't get in on the right line, so I'm calling. And Greta would just let them ramble on and spew their hate, man. It's Sailor Chick is right. It's getting to where it's unlistenable. Because the moderators do not take charge anymore.
But that almost sounds like a coordinated campaign, Steve.
Yeah, well, I think it is. And they're calling in the independents. No, independents. They're all fucking Trump supporters. Every one of them. And this went on. And they only did open phones for a half hour this morning. So I think they caught wind that they were being shanghaied, and they cut it short, you know.
Well, it'll be curious to see if that continues, that they just blow past the rules. I mean, there are rules. Yeah. This is not Vietnam.
Well, I mean, when Mr. Lamb was hosting the show and you called in on the wrong line, you were gone. He didn't tolerate that shit. And he's definitely no bleeding heart liberal by any stretch. It's just he had the show structured. Now it's just a fucking free-for-all, man.
Oh, by the way, I love this stuff because I'm simple. Stephen Colbert, I don't know if you noticed this, started a petition to have Cardi B deliver the official response to Donald Trump's State of the Union whenever it happens to go down. He tweeted, I'm starting a petition for the Democrats to let Cardi B give the rebuttal to the State of the Union. Sign it by retweeting this. She responded, why not? I get straight to the point. Government shutdown over. That would be funny. And, of course, it would drive it. I don't want to say that I think there's any sort of... But every one of these things is another straw on the orange camel's back. And the reason for that old saying, the straw that broke the camel's back, is that even though straw itself, individually, each piece by piece, is quite light, weight is weight, mass is mass. And eventually there's one straw that the camel cannot bear. And I think we may very well be approaching that with Julius Geezer. Darlene in Connecticut says, can someone please roll out that old videotape of Anthrax Coulter running and screaming off the stage like a banshee when some enterprising individual whipped a big-ass cream pie at her ugly mug during a speech she was making years ago? Talk about a wimp. Ralph Nader took a pie full frontal to the face and ate it for lunch. W deftly dodged a shoe but stood his ground. She ain't that tough. Maybe it's time to revisit that. I remember that. I'd forgotten that. Thank you for the reminder.
Oh, God, the radios are clicking off. Dennis, where you at, brother? You always got something to say.
I'm almost beginning to think this...
I'm here.
Okay.
All right. Yeah, weigh in, bro. Weigh in, man.
Where do you start? It's just been an overwhelming day. You want to dance, but you don't want to celebrate. You know, you don't want to go overboard because you know the same crap is going to happen in a few weeks. This is like a temporary reprieve so they can regroup. And in my opinion, he wanted to give the State of the Union. He knew he had to back down because of the airport's closing. The pressure from the Senate Republicans blaming McConnell and Pence, he had to give. He didn't have a choice. And if you notice in that speech, it was just wall, wall, wall. Like every other word was wall. I think he's trying to program people. I mean,
this is a fundamental miscalculation on his part, because with his approval numbers at 34%, he's down to that last hardcore, cancerous, poisonous little knot of losers and dead enders that form the maggot base. But 70% of the country doesn't want the damn wall. And so he can holler wall, and it might energize his base a little bit, but it looks like he lost the hell out of them today. And it's not gonna play with the rest of the country, because it's like that clip from Senator Michael Bennett of Colorado. What American is gonna say, yeah, let's steal other Americans' land and create a no man's land between somewhere in Texas and the Rio Grande River and put a bunch of Americans out in the cold? I mean, that is so anti-Republican principles, at least old-school Republican principles, it can scarcely be, you know, be expressed.
The maggots don't care. They don't care as long as it's somebody else being shafted.
Right.
They don't.
But Sailor Chick, are there enough of them?
I don't know anymore. Looks
that,
like
that
the
number's shrinking.
It's shrinking every day.
I've got one question. Can somebody tell me what is a smart wall?
Maybe it has a cell phone built in and takes pictures.
It's probably got electronics of some kind associated with
the whole wall.
Well, it's a desperate attempt to talk away from the fact that he's been accused of being medieval.
No, it's not going to be a medieval wall. It's going to be a smart wall.
With drones that are electronically activated.
But he's already on record as saying, no, drones won't do the job. It's got to be a physical barrier. We got to have a wall.
And did you hear that 300 people dug under one of the walls last week? Just hand dug under it. So the wall is just so silly. And to make so many good people hurt, close to a million people hurt, just pisses me off to no end.
Well, he said they were gonna make this wall like 20 feet into the ground. Can you imagine the cost of that?
Oh my God.
He just
throws out these numbers. Every time somebody says, well, they'll dig under it, he says, well, we'll just dig it deeper.
Well, do you remember when he was running and he said,
well, the wall just got 20 feet taller.
Yeah. I mean, how much?
It exists only in his own among the howlings of the spirochetes and the soup between his ears. I read a thread on Twitter, though, a week or so ago, from a no-kidding, honest-to-goodness civil engineer who said there's no way you can, even if he declares a national emergency and tells the military to build it, there's no way you can do the engineering and the architecture on it and the environmental impact statement and have it built. But then again, this dumbass said a couple of days ago that we're going to be on Mars by 2020.
With the Space Force.
He's not home. I come back to my previous thesis that if we had a functioning constitutional government, if we were not in and had not been since January 20th, 2017, in a constitutional crisis, the guy would not be president. if there was any, if there were just, you know, what, 25 Republicans in the Senate who took their job seriously and their oath to defend the Constitution. Because see, nobody, you take the oath, you're not, you don't swear to defend your political party. You defend the Constitution. And the Constitution has been under assault by this clown since his hand came off the Bible. If Mike Pence took his job seriously, Congress would have been dealing with the 25th Amendment letter a year ago.
But he can't mess up his his secretaries, his cabinet, because they paid him for their position.
Oh, by the way, Betsy DeVos is out there getting around on in a wheelchair or a walker now, right now, apparently. She broke a hip.
Oh, falling off a bicycle, yeah.
And yet, somehow or another, she didn't... I mean, a broken hip is not easy to get over.
No, it's not. I can tell you that, because I, with my volunteer EMS position, that's a lot of what I do, is transporting the very elderly who fall and break hips. And it can take months or even years to heal.
Right. And so how do you go on being Secretary of Education that way?
Oh, you got me. She won't be doing a lot of traveling.
It might be better in her absence, because she's not doing much for the people.
I saw a video earlier. It was music set to some video footage of Mike Pence looking at Trump. And I retweeted it, if you want to go find it on my timeline. And you can see my timeline over at headon.live from Twitter. But the person who tweeted it originally said, "Mike Pence isn't gay. But his impression of an 18-year-old closeted me looking at my hot straight friend is spot on." Go and see that video. The look, I mean, oh my God. But the other thing that struck me is that that's also a guy looking, thinking, "I want your job." Not just, "I want to give you a job," "I want your job."
So I was thinking today, Bob, or actually last night, wouldn't, instead of a wall, and this is just spitballing, how about structures like watchtowers where they can actually monitor and launch drones from be more economically feasible?
Well, I mean, yeah, but the larger issue is that It's a hell of a place to try to come across. And as long as, this is all a problem of their own making. Because given the opportunity, people will come to the ports of entry to make their asylum claims. You don't just sneak across the border and hope for the best, because in most places, it's a terribly inhospitable place. Oh, and by the way, some religiously motivated individuals are now facing felony charges, years-long prison sentences for leaving water and food in the desert in case some dying person would happen to need it and would run across it. When I read that story, yeah, it just drove me bananas.
Four people? Yeah, I read that article.
What would you convict them of, littering?
No, I mean, it's a specific statutory crime. And Agnes is looking for the story right now so we can do the particulars. But it just crawled all over me because if those four women had refused to bake a cake for a gay couple getting married, Mike Pence would have been out there pounding on the table, screaming about religious liberty. But if you got four women who are actually doing that stuff that the religion teaches about, you know, clothing the naked, feeding the hungry, sheltering the homeless, that sort of thing. No, we got a federal crime for that. And when you bring it up in a motion to dismiss in federal court and say, hey, we got to get rid of this because it's a violation of their deeply held religious beliefs, well, it'll probably get bounced out because it doesn't have anything to do with a corporation wanting to stop women from being able to get a birth control pill. Yeah, there it is in the chat room. Okay, I got it here too. They left food and water for migrants in the desert. Now they may go to prison. During the summer of 2017, when temperatures reached triple digits in Arizona, four women drove to a vast desert wilderness along the southwestern border with Mexico. They brought water jugs and canned food, items they later said they were leaving for dehydrated migrants crossing the unfriendly terrain to get to the United States. They were charged with misdemeanor crimes. Prosecutors then said they violated federal law by entering Cabeza Prieta, a protected 860,000-acre refuge, without a permit and leaving water and food there. A judge convicted them on Friday last.
So it almost looks like littering, leaving behind personal property.
Yeah, but they come from No More Deaths, an all-volunteer group in Arizona, and they face 6 months federal time. U.S. Magistrate Judge... Fine. Yeah, U.S. Magistrate Judge Bernardo Velasco said their actions violated the national decision to maintain the refuge in its pristine nature.
So are they going to start ticketing people that hand money to the panhandlers on all the corners?
Feeding hungry people has been criminalized in other American cities.
Good point, man.
But the thing is, what? Because I mean, I remember this very, very well. What happened when somebody said, "Oh, my closely held religious beliefs prevent"? Well, that's the Hobby Lobby case. And there is such a thing as a defense of necessity. It became necessary to violate this law because my conscience was being violated otherwise. But, you know, I guess people trying to do the Jesus work, that doesn't qualify for conscience. Just trying to stop women from controlling the workings of their own bodies does.
These people are so separated from Jesus Christ, it's not even funny. Or the teachings of him. I mean, I'm not a religious person, but I am knowledgeable on his speakings, and these people are so far removed that if he did have the powers that they claim he did, he would zap them all into hell right now, man.
You know, the women said their work for No More Deaths was motivated by their religious convictions and a belief that everyone should have access to basic survival needs. And the prosecutor said, hell no, fuck that, Jesus.
Something else that really grabs my goat is Crump keeps trying to criminalize all these people who aren't criminals. They're just trying to make a better way of life for themselves. Christ, if any of us were in this same predicament, we would do the same thing. The majority of these folks are not criminals. That's a proven fact. Yeah, maybe 1 in 10,000 is trying to, you know, smuggle something in, but I don't know. I'm just spitballing here, but you know, the way he's trying to criminalize people that aren't criminals, most of the contraband comes through the ports. You know, it's not over some stupid wall or where a wall should be. And it's frustrating. It's frustrating. And if Nancy is out there, I'd like to ask her a question.
You there? You there, Sailor Chick?
That's all right. I've only used this a couple of times, so.
I would like to hear your perspective from a government worker. I don't want to see you out of work again. Should Nancy compromise and say, okay, here's $2.5 billion for your stupid fucking wall? Coming from your perspective. And if you say yes, and I'm behind you 100%. Because I know how it is to not have a check or not know when one's coming in. It's like being sick. It's very painful, man.
Yeah, but I don't want her to give him money just to keep us working. You know, that really was a hostage situation. And he said it was a hostage situation. He said that we were his leverage.
Oh, it was. Well, and I wanted your perspective because you've lived it, you know. And I have a lot of respect.
Well, I wasn't as bad off as some other people because my husband's working and all that. But yeah. some of these people were, I mean, these TSA people living in their cars.
Going to soup lines. It's disgusting.
And the hideous remarks from the cabinet secretaries, like the one I work for, Wilbur Ross. What's he worth? $2.8 billion?
Oh, yeah. They can go get a loan.
This asshole says, why are they going to soup kitchens? Oh, my God. What is he, 81? He needs to just drop dead already. Ass. He's a dick.
Wouldn't you love to just...
The best thing I saw all day was some genius who took a clip of Montgomery Burns from The Simpsons.
Oh, I saw that. I fell
and put the Wilbur Ross audio into Montgomery Burns' mouth.
That was perfect, yeah. And you know, his emails to us are just as dry and colorless. We got one at the beginning of the shutdown. We never got another one. Now, the head of our medical sent us an email a couple days ago, filled with all kinds of stuff about well-being and taking care of one another and things like that. He took a long time to compose it. And he included a number of resources, including the suicide hotline. I mean, when your supervisors are sending you stuff about, please don't kill yourself, you know it's getting bad, right? So, yeah, but Wilbur Ross sent us this one little two-paragraph or whatever the hell it was email. It was dry, you know, wasn't supportive at all. My Gmail just logged me out, so I don't have it right at my fingertips. But he is definitely Mr. Burns. I saw that video, and I just felt...
I wonder if anybody could get him to say, release the hounds.
That would be fantastic. Did you hear about his $600 embroidered slippers?
Oh, no, that's new and lovely.
He's got a pair of custom embroidered slippers that he wore to one of Trump's big speeches, and it's actually got the Commerce Department logo.
Jesus Christ, man. And yes. He's out there telling people to take a loan at 9%.
And he's telling us to go take loans.
And 9% is cheap. You probably won't get one at that rate. It's probably going to be more like 16-17%.
Why are people in redline? Right. Jesus. Unbelievable.
Christ. What an ass. So wouldn't to be like honest, to be able to wave a wand and make him penniless and just to have him live what you guys had to live for the next month.
I just feel like we're all peasants to these people. We're just nothing but a bunch of peasants. The public kicks us around. Although I have to say it was very heartwarming to see the very many acts of kindness that were coming out too. It was really, really, I was really pleasantly surprised by the generosity and the kindness that people offered.
Well, not everybody's a dickhead. I'd say 30%.
No, I think most Americans are still pretty good people, you know.
Yeah, I would like to think so too. You know, I would like to think there's 30% tops dickheads, and every one of them calls into fucking Washington Journal. I'm about tired of it.
They actually read my tweet the other day, though. I sent them a tweet. Yeah, they read it on the air.
Cool.
Yep. Yeah, it was Brian. He's one of the better ones. So.
Yeah, you're articulate. You should call in sometime, you know.
Oh, no, I'd probably lose my cool and start cussing. Some lady called in the other day and they had to cut her off because she was so mad. Oh, she wanted to cuss out Trump and they cut her right off. You could tell she was going to launch into a tirade. But yeah, you get the feeling like a serf, you know, the demeaning comments from these people.
And people don't realize how.
And by the way, you can cuss to your little heart's content. You can cuss to your little heart's contempt here, Sailor Chick.
Yeah, I might once in a while, but.
I'm married to a postal worker. I see her putting in 16, 70 hours a week.
Oh,
fortunately,
yeah.
This did not affect her, you know, and I don't mean to sound selfish, but I'm just saying, fortunately for Karen and I, it did not affect us. But I understand, man. I get it. You guys work your fucking asses off, man.
We all do. There's
no, I know.
We have people like goof off like everybody else does, but you know, believe it or not, here's another myth. Federal workers can be fired. We fired a number of people last year. I mean, these were people, most of them I knew, and some of them had it coming, and some of them probably could have fought it, but they didn't. And it was a big sweep because of sexual harassment and some other things going on, and some people were shown the door. And so it is possible, and it gets done. So the myth that the federal worker is impossible to fire, that's absolute complete BS. You just have to document everything properly and you can do it.
I have a theory. I call it employment envy. That's because the 30% of the rubes that Trump's attract are too stupid to go out and get a government job. All they can get is, would you like some more fries with that? Not to disparage anybody that serves fries, you know, I'm not going there. Well, the government's always hiring. If you want a job with the government, go get one. The post office is always hiring. Always. They're hiring right now.
It's going to be even worse after this because recruiting is going to be hell.
Yeah, but the post office gives preference to veterans.
Well, that's good. That's a good thing.
I got into NOAA on a 5-point veterans preference. And my son works for the Army as a civilian on his 5-point veterans preference. And I told him, I said, you better save up some money in case you're next in September. And he laughed, and I said, don't laugh.
And
I said,
let me do it again. Let me back up. I wash dishes for a seafood restaurant. I'm not above serving fries. I'm just saying most of these people are too stupid to know how to better themselves. And I have a theory that it's employment envy because they can't get.
But, you know, they started their war on the federal workforce years ago.
Oh, Reagan did with the air traffic controllers, you know.
The nine most dangerous words in the language are, I'm from the government and I'm here to help. Mommy.
And Newt Gingrich and the whole gang.
That whole cabal. Yeah.
Well, let me ask you this, Sailor Chick. Do you have any confidence at all that this is going to get worked out are we going to shut down again on February 15th?
Well, see, Ann Coulter's already, you know, flicking him in the nuts. Okay, so I think he's gonna have to do something to save what little face he's got left. So I don't really know. That's an honest answer. I don't know. We'll just have to see. He doesn't like to go out without some kind of fight. and he doesn't seem to mind taking us all down with him.
Well, I'm sure that somebody will be polling. One of these groups will be polling. And I can't imagine that the maggots are going to be particularly proud of him because they were losing their shit all over social media today.
Oh, yeah. I started seeing that actually last night.
I'm waiting for somebody. I haven't seen it yet. I'm sure it probably exists. One of the more intrepid social media members of the Horn social media squad can probably find it. I would almost guarantee he's been called a cuck by now.
Well, Fox News was trying to spin it as a big win for the president. He's finally brought the Democrats to the table, and they're going to negotiate the wall. Well, they never said they wouldn't negotiate it. All they said was open the fucking government up, and then we'll talk. And it's just because they're going to negotiate it doesn't mean they're going to hand him a fucking wall on a silver platter.
There's a lot of people out there who don't know what kind of votes have been held and who held them and where. They don't seem to know the difference between the House and the Senate and who holds what.
Let me ask the group generally, did this weaken Chinless Mitch at all?
Yes.
Yeah, I think so.
Absolutely.
But
starting like, with that streaming
Nancy was just saying, a lot of the rubes don't know how this works because somebody, one of the rubes, called into Washington Journal today and said, I blame Congress. They've had all these votes they could have brought up. I was yelling at the TV. No, they couldn't, you dumbass. Not unless Chinless Mitch tables it. They can't bring shit up and vote on it, you know? They don't know how it works. They failed Civics 101, or they fell asleep, or they were, it wasn't even offered, you know?
Don't know how it works. They don't know how any of it works.
I'd give the nod to Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez for that Where's Mitch? Because, honestly, they were making it look like that Mitch was hiding from the Democrats, but honestly, I think he was hiding from the Senate Republicans.
He was.
He was in his hidey hole.
Because the Senate Republicans were beginning to crack. Other than the Freedom Caucus nut jobs, the rest of them were starting to lean on him.
An aide for Ron Johnson gave an interview to some media, I can't remember, I think it was Washington Post, that he called him out. And said, "This is your fault." With a there was a closed session Republican luncheon or something yesterday, and after both bills failed, he said, "This is your fault." And McConnell said, "Oh, do you think I'm enjoying this?"
Yeah, that was Ron Johnson, who's not the brightest bulb in the Republican Senate caucus, but he's smart enough to know when somebody's lighting a fire under his ass. And it's not like there's a paucity of federal workers in Wisconsin. And he's not, he's not even up for re-election in 20. Mitch is. And finally, there are billboards popping up in Kentucky, not promoting any particular candidate, because there is no particular candidate, but going after Mitch for the... Well, you know, being the un-American asshole that he is.
I saw some that were in Kentucky just in the shutdown, stuff like that.
Yeah, so, billboards with his picture on them, that sort of thing.
Mitch is just as complicit as Trump is, you know, in all this, because he didn't bring anything up for a vote. Stuff that they passed on unanimous consent on a voice vote, he wouldn't bring it up because he would go back into this old mantra, well, we're not going to bring it up, the president can sign it, American people. That's not how this works.
Did he go to Russia last July 4th? Was he part of that group?
I don't know, Bob.
I don't remember.
I don't remember either.
This is Trey from Kentucky State. What's going on, everybody?
Hey, Trey, what's happening, man?
Hey, what's going on, brother? Welcome.
Just reporting in here from White Privilege USA, Northern Kentucky State. As you know, everything is going on here. And the one thing that bill that they passed, is that the same exact bill that they put up when they were controlling Congress, the Republicans, to open the government back up?
I think it's similar.
Similar? Okay. I don't know. And I'm also signing right now for my shipment of fentanyl that I got from the U.S. Postal Service. And I got a truckload of marijuana out front that I got from the border. So that's how I make my money around here. I'm joking, guys.
You got the NSA at your door.
No, because I was getting on the road quick as the program's over.
I'm making the point that the port of entry is where the drugs are coming in. And fentanyl's coming through the U.S. Postal Service. So they're not coming from, like, underneath the ground and stuff like that. I'm making a joke. I'm not a drug dealer.
So.
Is this as fast as we can go? I can't believe I'm finally on a carriage ride the one night I don't want to be on a carriage ride.
Okay, what are we watching on TV?
Yeah, we got some feedback there.
Yeah. No, Mitch McConnell did not go to Russia.
Oh, okay.
That we know of.
I wasn't sure. I knew that there was a gaggle of them that went, and they didn't talk about it very much in the news.
Oh, here's a good talking point. Tomi Lahren and Brian Kilmeade are about to take the stage here in San Antonio in like 10 minutes for the Battle of the Border.
Oh, no.
Jesus. Wait.
What?
Wait, a little Eichmann Barbie and who?
–
Who was the one besides
the moron from Fox and Friends?
Oh, Kilmeade. Yeah, I did. Where's the battle then? That's going to be a love in.
I think.
I'll be surprised if Tommy Lauren doesn't wind up having to get a restraining order before it's over.
They're going to play a game of Louis San Antonio. To see who comes out ahead, guys.
Rick, what's up, hey, brother?
How you doing?
Fantastic, man.
Yeah, I got locked out of my Skype account for some reason. Don't know what happened.
This new Skype blows. It really does. I mean.
Yeah, so quite an eventful day, huh?
Yeah, oh, yeah, absolutely.
Man.
And I've got a lawyer question for you, Rick, later on when, you know, not
now. Okay. By the way, I got to leave at 6 o'clock, probably 5:55. I'm seeing Elton John's Goodbye Yellow Brick Road tour or whatever it is, Farewell Yellow Brick Road.
Well, let me shoot it at you now because it is relevant.
Yeah.
You know, if I stole something from you and I was convicted, I would have to give whatever I stole from you back.
Yeah, restitution, exactly. Uh-huh.
Technically, if Hillary was to file a lawsuit, if Stone gets convicted and all the bullshit comes out and it's definitely pointing at they stole this election, couldn't Hillary sue to get herself appointed in the seat,
no,
or is that just really reaching?
There's no mechanism
far?
For that. No, nope. That's a political issue. It's not it's not a legal thing, you know? So, okay. No.
I knew I was.
We need, ultimately, we're going to need a do-over, but there's no mechanism for having one of those.
No, there isn't. There isn't.
There needs to be.
Oh, sure. Of course there does, but that's the flaw of our system. If we were a parliamentary democracy, then you can call a snap election and get the person out of office right away. You know, I don't know if there's a mechanism to like undo things that have already occurred. You know, how can you unring the bell? That's always the problem. You know,
that's interesting, Rick.
The biggest thing you'd want to unring would be the Supreme Court.
Yeah. Yeah, well, the only way you could do that is if you could somehow show that, you know, Brat, I like beer, Kavanaugh, perjured himself in the testimony. But, you know, in terms of getting somebody to go along with filing such a charge, it could never happen in a Republican administration, you know.
Yeah,
you'd have to have a Democratic attorney general file that criminal action, you know.
Can they go back on those, like, I want to say it was like 60 conduct unbecoming charges they did throw out at him because he was already?
No, they can't.
No, that's those have become.
Those were mooted. Those were mooted out by virtue of his elevation to the Supreme Court.
Yeah. Those are not. Those are moot. They're not. They're not just. What is it?
Justiciable. They are neither germane nor justiciable, and they are rendered moot by virtue of the fact that he was elevated to the Supreme Court.
Exactly. And, you know, the thing is, there is no code of judicial conduct that governs Supreme Court judges, whereas there is one for Circuit Court of Appeals judges, just one step below.
Right.
The
Supreme Court, the members of the Supreme Court are a law unto themselves, with
right.
the single exception of an actual criminal charge.
Mm-hmm.
Or impeachment. And so right. we find ourselves back to the dare to dream, dream big.
Pelosi as president. Scenario.
Well, no, dream big. Defend all 13 Democratic seats in the Senate and take all 20 Republicans. And then if you've got the House, you can do any damn thing you want to, up to and including throwing out every Republican in the Congress.
And,
see,
know,
most people don't know that there's a provision in the Constitution that says if you have a 2/3 vote, you can throw out anybody you want to.
Right, right.
House or Senate.
Well, ironically, Bob, if we have to have a clean sweep of the 20 Republican seats to get from 47 to 67, which is exactly just over the 2/3 requirement in the Senate.
Yeah.
Not going to happen, but, you know, we can dream
big.
Well,
no, quit that. You can't say it's not going to happen. We are way far away from that. And if we want
if you want it bad enough
and you organize hard enough, it can happen.
Well, I'll tell you what, it's going to take a lot of dead hookers and a lot of live boys, you know, for those Republicans to all lose their seats, Bob. To be a little coarse here.
Well, that's why Isaacson crossed party lines and voted to end the shutdown today, which I was shocked. I mean, him and Perdue, they just, like Bob always says, they got their heads so far up Trump's ass, if he smiled, you could see their face, you know. And I was shocked, but Isaacson's up for re-election in 2020. So
that
drives everything, man.
Yeah. You know what I saw, man, when I saw that report about the slowdown at LaGuardia and Newark and Philly, it's like, oh my God, look at this. This is, you know, there should be like 65 planes in the air headed towards Newark or towards LaGuardia, and there were only like 7 at the time. They were showing it on CNN.
Yeah, and it was about to start rolling like a tsunami east to west across the country.
Right. And I basically said, okay, I think the jig is up because Trump has now pissed off the business class who are his campaign contributors, you know, and he's inconveniencing them now, not just some, you know, government employee dweebs who, you know, haven't gotten paid for over a month, you know. So I figured, you know, with the Super Bowl coming up as well, I mean, does Trump want to have to deal with that with a, you know, air traffic control crisis when everybody's trying to go to Atlanta for the big game? I mean, I don't think so.
And Rick, I think there's another component that nobody's mentioned, but it's one of the first things that hits me. His ego is so huge. He knew if he didn't come to some kind of short-term consensus, the State of the Union was off the table. And I think that played a big role in it. And
well,
nobody's
Nancy,
talking about that, you know?
Nancy definitely found his soft spot there, State of the Union speech, you know?
Because the pomp and circumstances and all that, he lives for that shit, you know?
Oh, God, it's just, you know, it's just...
Oh, you guys will love this, granted, talking about video again, but Joy sent me a graphic earlier today. And she just said, Bob, this is beautiful. And it's a kind of like a mock-up of a Pornhub page. And it shows a picture of Trump standing at the podium this afternoon. And it says, plus-sized bigot submits to mature femdom. That's gorgeous. That's just beautiful. Plus-sized bigot submits to mature femdom.
So, Bob, let me ask you, do you think the State of the Union had any part in his acquiescing today?
I think it all piled up, but no, I think the two, he was desperate to do something to get Roger Stone out of the news, and then secondarily, when people who know the gravity of the penalties they face under Taft-Hartley for calling for a general strike,
and shit was going to hit the fan.
It was going to go.
Yep.
I mean, no TSA, the official position of NATCA, which is the replacement to PATCO, who all got fired by Ronnie. Their official position was, no, we're not going to go on strike. But ultimately, you can't stop them if you're. It's kind of like what happened in West Virginia last year. The teachers walked out, and the teachers' union said, okay, we've made a deal. Everybody go back to the classroom. And the teachers said, fuck off. We haven't gotten anything. And so, you know, if they're willing to take the risk, it happens. And so that the threat of a rolling general strike across the United States is terrifying. And it would have meant he lost. I mean, he may as well have just quit and turned it over to Pence.
That was set for Tuesday, right, Bob?
At the latest.
Yeah, there was a major protest set for Tuesday. Yes.
So a general strike among government employees, or who, among who?
Well, not just. But the thing is, if it's a general strike, the one of the people, the head of the flight attendants union.
Oh.
Said, and that ain't government, said, get ready to go.
Right. Yeah.
I feel so good about that because I'm in a union and I was starting to feel really like,
un-unionized,
like we were just losing any power we had, you know?
Solidarity is a beautiful thing, man. And it's still
the
there.
People walking off the job across the country, you know, to shut this nonsense down. I just think I would have wept.
Yeah, that's wonderful.
It would have been incredible.
And as brutal as continuing the shutdown would have been, it might have been, and maybe we got close enough that maybe flexing a little bit of muscle showed people what they can do.
That's what people need to see.
Yeah, but the vibrancy of a labor movement that insists on the absolute control over the right to withhold its labor. I mean, the right to withhold labor is the only thing a working person has. And so maybe there's a mindset changing here.
Well, Bob, can I ask you to put on your prophet coat with the stars and the moons and all that?
Yeah, and Will Thee Kiss Me in the Dark, Baby, written in glow in the dark, paint across. Let me wait a minute. Hold in here. Let me let me get out the magic eight ball. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Screen still cracked. Still says answer hazy. Ask me again later. Go ahead.
Perfect. Come day after Valentine's Day, do you think Trump's going to declare a state of emergency, or do you think he's going to shut the government down again?
I think he'll shut the government down again. He's a chicken shit. Because
that makes my heart ache.
I don't know. I don't know if he will or not.
Hey, John.
He's got two options.
Uncle
Hello,
John.
Bob. How y'all doing this evening? I'm sorry I'm late
John,
again.
How you doing, buddy?
Doing fine. We're still shuffling around with Rose's car being in the shop, so I still have to do shuttling, same as last Friday. But
for my 10 cents worth,
you're
I don't
here
think
now,
Trump
brother.
Has the stomach to shut down the government again. He's already shut it down for 35 days in this quarter, and he's all about GDP and numbers for the economy. And if there's another shutdown this quarter, we're going to probably have zero growth for the quarter.
I think what he's going to – I don't know if he's going to shut it down again. I think he ain't got the huevos enough to do it. He's already been bit once. Now, the declaring a national emergency, that's his way out because it's not going to work. It's going to be challenged in the courts, but he can say, I tried.
Look at your minions.
If it wasn't for the evil government fighting me, I could do this. That's his out.
But the problem is he waited too long to declare the emergency.
That's really an emergency. That's the part that...
Like
that,
35 days, you know?
Can you elaborate on that, Rick? Is there a time frame where you have to, I mean...
Well, no.
It's not an emergency at all within the meanings contemplated by the statute.
Right. Yeah, an emergency means a matter of days,
mean that his minions know that. His little followers, his little cockroaches, they don't know all that.
They're
shit.
The most...
All they're
going to
know is
no,
Donnie's going up against them again. Yeah.
No, they don't know it. No, of course they don't.
If he tries to shut it down again after this time, maybe that's hell for the Republican Party, and everybody knows it. His only way out is to try to declare an emergency and then just let it get tied up in the courts and say, oh, my, I just tried as hard as I could.
Or what he could do is he could try to shift some of the funds that he has at his discretion into building a wall. But that'll get tied up in the courts.
Rick, he's got $1.6 billion.
And he doesn't he have
that
the
he hasn't touched
authority to transfer funds? Doesn't he, at his disposal, being the president, doesn't he have the constitutional authority to transfer enough funds to get the $5.5 billion to start his wall?
He might.
Only if he declares a national emergency. Other than that, he can't be dipping around.
Right. If he declares national
Congress
emergency,
has the,
that
he
does
has
not
the
have to go through Congress, though, does it?
If
national
he declares
emergency?
No.
It's like a dictate.
Emergency. He goes through it.
To dictate, like Hitler would do.
So what's the recourse?
Short of that, though, he can't.
The recourse is the court system, Steve.
Right.
But look who's ahead of that, Bob. When it comes down to it, the Supremes, you got Bart and his buddies, and they have the majority. I mean,
you feel
like we're boxed in here, man.
You know, Steve, don't quite feel that way. I think we do have, because of his concern about the institution of the court, Roberts has surprised us several times, especially
and he is
with
the head.
The healthcare.
He does have influence. Yes, that's true.
So, and I think there is a certain tiring of certain members of the Supreme Court of Trump's, like, you know,
high-handed tactics, you know. And so, they're not necessarily going to just rubber stamp everything.
But
we have that going for us. I mean, it's kind of a thin reed to rely on, but, you know, we got something.
Bart's statement of what comes around goes around chills me to the bone.
Yeah, well, you know, he's just a vindictive prick is what he is, you know.
Right, he has no
But, there, I mean, there is reason to think, because somebody brought up dead-eyed John Roberts, that he might vote with the other side if there is a reasonable interpretation of the statute to be had that says this ain't what that statute contemplates.
Right.
Right.
Because that's what it's going to boil down to. You got to go and read the statute that the Supreme Court would ultimately have to interpret.
Right.
Oh, and I got some thanks to send out. We have finally finished with Charlene's challenge. That's huge.
Oh, y'all had a challenge? I missed the challenge?
The other half of the challenge, thanks to Ralphs and Darlene of the Sorority of Leans and a member of the Sisterhood of Queen Tracy's Rocks, and Alma jumped in, as did just a second. Let me get all this. As did Gary. So I can happily announce that we are now down to. We're now down to about $100 to go to finish tonight.
Oh Lord!
And
we can raise that.
And the
okay, Bob.
And finish the month of January.
Tell you what, Bob. In honor of Sir Elton John's concert coming up tonight at the Staples Center, I will do a farewell to challenges challenge.
Okay.
A farewell challenge.
$25, and if it is met, I'll double that to 50, and then we'll be almost there.
That'll leave only 25 to go. The farewell to challenges challenge is on the table through the remainder of the program.
I wish I could jump in there, Bob, but I got robbed, buddy.
I know you did. I saw that.
I got robbed, yep. They got my card. Yep. They hacked my card. I think it happened at a gas station where they skim it, I guess. And,
yeah, you got nicked.
Yep.
Were you using it? And did you use the card at the pump or something?
Yep, I used the card at the pump. Put the PIN number in there. And
yeah, don't never do that.
Not again, baby. Within 45 minutes, they had that card in Austin, at a Home Depot. And they made three major purchases, and then the fourth time they went to go get $200 out of the ATM, and it said no. So, thank goodness it shut it down.
Uncle John, take heart. Most reputable banks will back you up on.
My bank has already returned the funds into my account. Thank goodness, because I wouldn't be able to make a house payment.
Right, but exactly. It'll be under investigation, and as long as you know that they're proved that there's no shenanigans, you're golden.
Yeah,
but the problem is,
I ain't got a car.
Right, in the interim, you're screwed. It happened to me in Manassas, Virginia, a few years back. I used one of those, at the pump, and I got nicked. And the next thing I know, some asshole's trying to spend money in Verdun, fucking France.
Ooh.
And I'm like, oh no.
You mean you didn't go to France, Bob?
No, I was not anywhere. I was in Manassas. I was in Manassas, Virginia, and so I called, and they were like, "Oh, that's terrible. Well, you know, we'll put the money back in." Well, that's great. Oh, when can you get me a car? Can you overnight me a car? Oh no, that's going to take 6 weeks.
Oh geez.
And so so you're sweating your head off for the next 6 weeks, you know, and call, well, I'm sorry, I can't pay the power bill, you know, because I'm in a card, you know, 6 weeks, be happy to have you, and you're just screwed.
Yeah, I got hit. Some asshole was charging up Swedish porn. Imagine me trying to explain that to Miss Karen, you know. Yeah. You know, wasn't me, hon.
It wasn't me.
And this is back during the early internet days, and it was the wild frontier. You know, she's looking at me all.
Oh, wait a minute. Okay, so this is going to screw up the file, but we got to do that. You just said something. We've got a theme song for you trying to explain that to the lovely Miss Karen.
She looking at me all funny and shit. You know, I was like, it wasn't me. I promise, I didn't do it. in the statement. It's like,
yeah, that's what they all say.
Yeah, hold on, hold on.
$9.99 per minute, you know, charged from Sweden to talk to, you know.
Yeah, this is Inga. I love you very much. Here we go. What was that you said? It wasn't me?
My girl just caught me. You made her catch you? I don't know how I let this happen. The girl next door, you know? I don't know what to do.
Say it wasn't you.
All right. Honey came in and she caught me red-handed, creepy with the girl next door. Picture this, we were both butt naked, banging on the bathroom door. How could I?
Yeah, the lesson. It wasn't me.
I feel its pain. But finally, I convinced her.
God, it's hard to believe how long that song's been out.
And they did. The credit card company backed me, and that didn't cost me a penny. But it was a process, you know. You have to work through it.
Yeah, it wasn't no fun because it happened on a long weekend. You know, Memorial Day weekend, MLK weekend here, and it happened on
that,
Friday.
Usually when it happens, yeah, if it's a long weekend, it'll happen that Friday night when you got to wait, you know, 4 days.
Funny thing is, I guess those little scanners are, I don't know what they look like, but they just walk up and they pop it on the tank, and, you know, some guy making minimum wage is not going to go out there and make sure there aren't any card nicking devices.
No, they try to make it look just like the normal device. It just slips right over that card swipe thing, I guess. Now, when I went back to the gas station, because I went in there to tell them, and that lady's looking at me like, well, we can't give you your money back. And I'm telling her, I don't want your money. I'm just telling you, I know that's where it happened. And but yeah, they make those things, I guess. So, you know, it's been on the news. That's what pitiful is.
Yep.
I saw it on the news down here not long ago in our neighborhood.
Uncle John, you got cloned, and there was a camera that seen you punching in your pin.
Yep.
Probably is what I'm thinking.
No,
the
all
scammer,
that stuff.
The thing that you put in there, when you punch in your pin, it's reading
it's
everything it's doing.
Well, okay.
Right, and it's wireless.
Yeah.
Because it transmits from the pump to elsewhere. And the other reason that I never use the pay at the pump option is simply because if you do that, depending on what who you're dealing with, they'll hang as much as like a $75 hold on the card, even if you only get $10 worth of gas.
Right.
Yeah. That's the last time I'm doing it at the pump. I ain't doing that again because it just really caused a whole lot of mess.
No, take it in, charge it inside. You know, it's much safer if you got to charge it. You know?
Yeah. And they say it's better to use your debit card as a credit card anyway. So there's more protections involved, I guess.
I've heard it's best to use a credit card because back in the day, I don't know if this still holds true, credit cards are easier to, you can dispute it with a debit card.
Yeah, there's more protections under a credit card than there is a debit card.
Even if you got to charge $20 worth of gas and trot right home and then switch the money back from your back to credit, I mean.
Well, you know, the sad thing is if this would have happened 2 days prior, they wouldn't have got a dime. Maybe they hit me right after the check
bounced.
Hit the bank. Yep, it would have gone through for squat.
It would have bounced from here to Texas.
Yeah, it would have said, sorry, get your broke ass out of here. We ain't giving you no gas.
Those fuckers. God damn. Uncle John, I'm sorry you had to go through.
It's one of those things in life, you know. Everybody gets hit once in a while.
Speaking of life, somebody had a birthday yesterday.
Oh!
You.
I was guessing that might be Brother John.
Yeah, I turned 66 yesterday. How about that shit? How about that
shit? Well, happy.
I was in that club once.
Yeah. Oh, the 66 club?
Yeah, but now I'm in 67.
You moved on.
Well, I hope you had a sublimely happy birthday, card nicking notwithstanding.
Notwithstanding, yeah, we still haven't got our new card yet. But no, it was a nice birthday. I went live. I got so many messages on Facebook and stuff that you couldn't, no way you could answer all of them. So I went live on Facebook and told the family how much I appreciate them. You know, and it keeps growing, baby. This family keeps getting bigger.
Tell them about the box of candy.
Oh, that's so cool. I go to the post office on my birthday there, and I pick up a package in there. And there's two boxes in the pack. It's one wrapped in one, but there's a square box, and we opened it up first. And it was a tub of cheese and habanero pepper spread, like you spread on a cracker or something, for hors d'oeuvres or something. Like, boy, the stuff was really good. And then we opened up the obviously it was a, it looked like a chocolate box, you know, thin and wide and long. And I opened it up, and sure enough, it was candies in there. But and this came from the factory, mind you. And on the candies, spelled out on each individual candy in letters, it said "Happy Birthday, Blue Dot." And we thought that was rather cool. So told everybody you could eat the, you can eat the pieces that don't have a letter on it. Those will be your last ones that you're gonna eat. It says "Happy Birthday, Blue Dot." That's really cool. That was sent to us by somebody named Linda, and I haven't dug in to find out which Linda it was. We have
Whoever Linda is awesome.
Yes, she is. Yes, she is. The habanero cheese thing really went over big time in the family, and of course, who don't like a box of chocolates? You know, actually, these are more like little pedophores, got a little cake inside, and you know, like I said, on top of one is D-O-T on the. Spells it all out. So, yeah, I had a great birthday. And sure beats the alternative, Papa. You know, I don't want to stop having them yet. Hell, I just now got started.
You're just now figuring, you're just now figuring shit out.
I'm just now getting there, baby. I'm late to the party, man. I'm what, 65 years old before I even, before I started, I guess I was 64 then, I guess, when I turned on my camera. Yeah, old man, you know, we get pissed off. We don't give a shit no more. I'm going to give him my peace of mind, baby, and I did today. I thought it was a rather eventful day, and I was just tickled to death over the whole scenario today. The Roger Stone thing and then caving on the shutdown. I was just giddy. I was just like a little teenage girl. Woo! I was so happy. Ha!
John and I both.
Yes, we were. Just tickled to death over that shit. And it's coming, people. I'm telling you. This is just the start. Like I said before, it's those Republican senators that we have to turn, and that crack is already in there. I understand after they didn't pass those two bills in the Senate there, Dennis was telling me that the GOP met behind closed doors. Ain't that right, Dennis?
And yeah, they had a luncheon.
They had a luncheon yesterday, and
yeah.
went after Chinless Mitch with a will.
There you go, baby. That's the way it's going to work.
They should have gone after him with a ball bat.
Yes, sir.
Never. That's a joke. Crowd. It's a joke.
Of course.
Well, baby steps.
We don't do violence. Now, if a limb were to fall out of a tree after getting hit by lightning and fall right on his head, well, that would be God's wrath. So.
You're right.
But, well, when all those Republican senators are out of a job in 2 years, they might not put down the bat.
That's what it's going to take. It's going to take the pressure on those Republican senators. It's just going to get so bad and so obvious. You know, with this shit today, you know, that just, you know, that one little paragraph they say in there where a senior advisor was told to go contact someone. Well, who the hell's telling a
directed
senior advisor
to do something? Drive, baby. Who? Yes.
Yeah, who would that be? I think it might be individual one in cahoots with organization one and Roger Stone and everybody else in that cahoots. It's
that whole shit house is going to go up in flames pretty soon.
But again, this is just small things. You know, these are all just, it's just like the campaign finance. It's just like this thing they had the other day, and I forgot what it was. Hell, but news cycle done, moved on. But yeah. We're just stacking them up one by one by one.
Well, I tell you what, I got a damn fine question here posed by Darlene in Connecticut. Can we even take it on face value that Trump would really allocate the $5.7 billion to the wall or slats or whatever it is, whatever it's being called this week?
Spent the 1.6 last time.
Bingo.
Trump Tower Moscow, folks.
$5.7 billion is a pretty specific figure if you think about it. And well short of what is needed to build a 200-mile-long barrier. I just keep having this nagging feeling that Trump has designs on that money for something else that will accrue to his personal financial benefit. He's all about the he's all about the Benjamins. So how could he pass up $5.7 billion right there at his fingertips? The wall was originally meant to be a campaign canard, and Trump is a pathological liar. I can totally see him shifting the use of those dollars once they're in hand, and his supporters will still support him. There may be an ulterior motive. And Trump's entire campaign and presidency is, after all, an ulterior motive.
Yes, it is. It was a mistake. He, like, this whole damn wall, you know, he preached that during his campaign. As we discussed, I don't think he meant to win. I don't think he knew he was going to win or thought he was going to win. So he could say anything we want. Mexico's going to pay for it. We're going to build the biggest wall that just got 10 feet taller and all that bullshit. And then he became president. Now he's stuck with it.
Here's the thing, though. And this is a little bit of an inherent contradiction inside the whole investigation. And I'm not necessarily disagreeing with you, John. But if he didn't expect to win and didn't think he was going to win, then why all the fuss and finagle with the damn Russians?
Well, as far as Trump was concerned, it's publicity.
Can you imagine trashing Hillary and...
He could say anything he wants, and he still does. Now, I'll tell you what, I'd rather think that it was an accident that he got there than the pure...
But it seems pretty obvious to me that Mother Russia certainly wanted him to be there.
Oh, yes. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, they wanted him. So did Saudi Arabia and anybody else that had a dollar in this fight. You know, Well, I don't think, it could be either way, but I just don't think he thought he was going to win. I think he thought he was just going to walk out, you know, and be able to bitch the rest of his life about it. You know, I got rigged. It was rigged. It was all cheated. And by the way, come by and watch my show on TV.
Yeah, Uncle John, I think it was a setup for him to open another Fox News or something to compete with Fox News. That was his pivot point. You know, and I really believe that, like Trump News. I don't think he expected to win at all either. Because if you read a lot of these accounts of what happened, they were all distraught when they won.
Yeah, they were shocked.
And in fact, Melanoma was crying, you know.
You could just see their expressions. They were shocked, their faces.
Yeah, I don't think he expected to win, but he did. And he did. And how he got there is a major story. And what he's doing while he's in there is the big story. I swear he's trying to tear this country down stick by stick, baby.
Hand it
over to Mother Russia. You know,
WikiLeaks is part of this. And in the meantime, and I don't know how many people know this, but back in 2016, at roughly the same time that WikiLeaks said, wait a minute, we're talking about Julian Assange here. Got to get the right voice. Yeah. Mike. We'll be happy to publish anything Gucci for 2.0 sends our way, because after all, we're a government organization. Skippy the Kangaroo and I will go right out there and publish everything you got on the DNC.
There you go, baby.
Well, they did that, but at the same time, they were also offered from an organization called... DDoS secrets, distributed denial of secrets, they were offered a tranche of materials, 175 gigabytes, on dirty dealings inside the Kremlin. And then all of a sudden, the guy who lives in the basement of the Ecuadorian embassy said, "Nah, that sounds like a bit too much. I don't think we want to be publishing that. It doesn't sound like the mission of a foreign transparency organization like WikiLeaks." Because Julian understood that he'd be getting one of those little polonium chips right up his fundament.
Yeah, right up. Poke with an umbrella, baby.
And that would be the end of Julian Assange. And they bury him in the basement of the Ecuadorian embassy.
Ever to be seen again.
And that of course was old cousin Crocodile Kincaid, yes. before Ron and Raleigh can ask. But I mean, that's a hell of a note, because apparently it's got all kinds of filthy shit in it. documents from the Russian arms exporting agency, a hacking spree from Russian targets of falsifying the story. Remember when the passenger plane Malaysia Airlines was shot down over Ukraine?
Yes,
they hacked that and got that information. And somehow or another, something as important as a Malaysian plane being shot down over Ukraine by the Russians. Nah, that doesn't sound very interesting to me. Don't you have anything on Hillary Clinton?
Yeah, that's a seller right there. Basically.
But it was straight up offered to WikiLeaks, and WikiLeaks said, nah, thanks, we'll take a pass.
Shit. I'm telling you, the powers that be, baby. You know.
By the way, just a separate topic. I did mention that this is Burns Night, and this is the night that we commemorate the birth of Scotland's greatest poet, Robert Burns. And now you said something about having some Irish whiskey on hand, Steve. Do you have any Scots so that you can properly toast Robbie Burns?
Yes, I do, lad.
Aye, then you'll have to set aside the sexton and bring out the good whiskey.
Ooh, pop the cork on that one.
Mm-hmm.
Would Jameson be considered an Irish?
No, that's Irish.
Okay, I have to send Karen to the store. She won't like you for this one.
Well, you kind of let Burns Night go by.
How dare you? You shall be drawn and quartered, man, I tell you. I had a little, what they call it, sloon shine on my show today, Friday, you know, Beer and Bud Friday.
Mm-hmm.
One of our family members had sent me little bottles of, I guess they're from the Full Throttle Saloon there in Tennessee. And one of them was a vanilla flavored moonshine, and the other one was an espresso shot. I drank a little bit of that vanilla-flavored moonshine today on the show and toasted up and sparked up my bowl. So, got Friday all kicked off, baby.
That sounds right fine.
Yes, it was. It was pretty good. I was surprised with the taste. Now, mind you, I do have a half a mason jar left of moonshine that my brother brought me from Tennessee, probably 2 years ago, and I still got half of that jug in there. Of course, it's a pretty good-sized jug. And we don't touch it very often.
Mr. Kincaid, I do have some Sexton single malt. Would that qualify, sir?
Nay, that's Irish.
Irish, yes.
Damn it. Karine!
Karine. Aye, tis a fine Scots name. So, on Robert Burns Night, you have to read Robert Burns poetry. And this is my favorite Robert Burns poem. It's called To a Louse. On seeing one on a lady's bonnet at church. Ha! Where are you gone, you crawling fairly? Your impudence protects you sairly. I canna say, but you strunt rarely o'er gauze and lace. The faith, I fear you dine but sparely on sic a place. Ye ugly, creeping, blasted wanner, detested, shunned by saint and sinner. How dare you set your fit upon her, so fine a lady? Gae somewhere else and seek your dinner on some poor body. Swith in some beggar's hoflet squatty, there ye may creep and sprawl and sprattle, with her kindred jumping cattle, in shoals and nations where horn nor bane ne'er dare and settle your thick plantations. The way he talks about that louse, and I'll let it go there, but it's almost like hundreds of years ago he was describing Donald Trump.
Yeah. Yeah. Bob, how
you
much,
ugly
how many,
creeping.
How many voices do you have in your head anyway?
It's like the Hallelujah fucking chorus by the Moron Tabernacle Choir in my head, John. It's not a pretty place.
I bet that's a happy place up in there, Bob. I'm telling you.
I can just sit there and listen to myself argue with myself. But, I mean, that is so Trumpian. You ugly, creeping, blasted, wanner, detested, shunned by saint and sinner.
Yeah, fucking asshole.
You know, I got the St. Augustine, the Scottish flag hanging up in my...
Oh, the St. Andrew's cross.
Yes, I have it hanging up. I have two right off the top of my head, Miss Claire Dines. She is in Hove. And
tis a fine ensign, a fine ensign.
And yes, it is. It's beautiful. I kept it right up there on the front. And Miss Claire Dines, I mean, Juliet Finney, she is in the Crook of Devon. I know about that because I read about the Crook of Devon in a National Geographic magazine years ago.
And Mr. Kincaid, was Rudyard Kipling, would he be a candidate for tonight's festivities?
No, no, this is strictly Robert Burns. This is Robbie Burns' night. No, damned English colonialist.
Bring some fine Scotch whiskey in there.
Well, I kind of feel left out. I can't do any accents.
Well, me neither, Bob. That's it. The only one I have is the one that comes out of my mouth right now.
I do it poorly.
I can do my best Southern drawl, though.
Well, see, that's being able to do one.
Mr. Kincaid is multi-talented, man.
I mean to tell you. So how are we doing on that challenge out there? I know there's somebody out there just itching to give up.
I am proud to announce a few minutes ago, thanks to Mark in Florida, we are done.
Buddy, yes!
Rick's challenge has been met and then some, and we are done for the month of January, only a little over a day late. And so that means all next week is Fundraising Free Radio. And while it may not mean as much to some folks as it does to me, but my God, to be able to do a week of radio without having to hoot and holler about...
Yeah, but y'all just now remember, just because he ain't hooting and hollering about sending a dime in, don't think that you're getting off easy. If you can, support the show. That's what it's about.
Well, I'll tell you, it's about
supporting the show and the message it puts out, baby. So,
well, I'll tell you truthfully, in all sincerity, John, what I'd really love to see happen, and you'd have to, I'll repost it over on my Facebook page. I've got a birthday fundraiser going on Facebook, not for the horn. This doesn't do anything for me or for the horn, but rather it's for the Appalachian Communities Health Emergency Campaign.
Outstanding.
The AIC campaign. That bill, the AIC Act, that we got introduced in the Congress back in 2012, will be reintroduced here in the next couple of months in the House of Representatives. And this is the first time we've got a Congress in which we've got a fighting chance of passing
it. Get it passing. There you go.
The only problem being, we have to be able to, and I don't know if people know, but you have to work a bill. Somebody, yes. Anytime a bill passes through the House or the Senate, somebody who is not a member of the House or Senate is there working it and walking the halls and knocking on the doors.
If you don't, it won't get nowhere.
Yeah, right.
Called lobbyists. Yep.
That's right.
They work on K Street. Yep.
Or in the case of a bunch of poisoned hillbillies, we're just called citizens.
Those are the most powerful ones, buddy. If you get enough of them, those are the most powerful ones.
And so we've done the work for the past... Uh-oh, ciphering on the fly. This never plays well. For the past 7 years, 7 years, we've been going back and forth to Washington, D.C. And we're trying to raise enough.
To fight for that.
Yeah, to fight for that. And there's not a lot of us who can do the work because a lot of the people who are affected by this are too sick. They're just too sick.
Our lives
it's expensive, too. You know,
our lives begin to end the day we stop caring about this kind of stuff. So, yeah, if you're out there and you got a dime or a dollar in your pocket that you feel that you can kick up on something like that, that's where the power comes in, baby. That's the power of people reaching out to effect change.
And if you can't...
Sometimes it's only the people that'll do that.
Right, ideally, and if you can't find...
If, on K Street,
if
you, know,
you can't,
ideally.
If you can't find the birthday, because yours was yesterday, mine is a week from yesterday. If you can't find that, you can just go to crmw.net. There's a PayPal link there, and just in the memo, put ACHE campaign. But on my Facebook page, if you do that, they'll know immediately, and you can put ACHE campaign in the memo there too. Once upon a time, we actually, and this was before mountaintop removal stopped being sexy enough to pay attention to, and back before a certain organization declared that mountaintop removal was over, even though it wasn't. The organization shall remain nameless, but they were, you know, ostensibly on our side. We actually, for a couple of years, we had a little basement apartment in D.C. And so I'd go up there for a couple of weeks at a time. My colleague Bo would go up there for a couple of weeks at a time. And every day you get up and you go and you work the halls and you sit there and you send letters and you set up meetings with legislative aides and assistants and the environmental aid and things like that. And you sit and you explain to them, because you'd be surprised the number of people who don't know what's going on here.
All
right. Well, Bob, I'm
going to show... And why would they know?
I'm going to show my ignorance here. If I may, excuse me, Uncle John. I'm sorry, I don't mean to walk.
No. Go ahead.
But Bob, ideally, wouldn't it be behoove you guys to have a small office on K Street?
Not on K Street. We couldn't afford that in a million years. But if we could, but if we had, and we calculated it once upon a time, if we could have a little the same little crummy apartment, and it was pretty crummy, in the Methodist building there, right across from the Supreme Court. It was perfect because you walk across the street and you're in the Senate office buildings, and you walk a block and you're in the House office buildings. And we would literally go there and live for a week on beans and rice and then come home.
So the answer to my question is yes. I mean, not K Street, but somewhere nearby, correct? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because you've got
donors out there that are willing to pitch in and do so. Look how much they raised for a border wall, border wall. It's the power of people out there that have the ability to give $1, $10, $5, whatever it is. But that combined effort can do so much for good, not for an ignorant wall or some bullshit reason, but for things that really make a difference for all of us. Yes.
Appalachia is beautiful. We can't fuck this up.
It is gorgeous.
We cannot fuck this up. If
this is one earth, baby. One earth. Think about that. One earth. We don't have another one.
Yeah, there's no planet B.
No,
They keep looking for
us. Yeah, and they will. They'll find you, baby. But it's going to be another million years from now, maybe before the sun burns out. I hope they'll find it. But it's not next year, and it's not 10 years from now, and it ain't 20.
No, and it's like
it's hidden behind the dark side of the moon, I thought.
A long time ago, I did an interview with a scientist from the University of Maryland named Margaret Palmer. And she was deep into the early research on the health effects of mountaintop removal. And I asked her on this program, how long will it take a mountaintop removal site to become, once again, a viable part of a living ecosystem? And she said, not less than 300,000 years.
They think they could plant little pine trees and make everything right.
That's the thing. We have already
damaged our environment that this asshole that is in there right now.
We've already ruined. We've already turned into those 300,000 year moonscapes an area in Appalachia equivalent or greater than the size of the state of Delaware. Imagine little Delaware over there, and the whole thing's just a moonscape. That's what mountaintop removal has done to Appalachia.
And events like this are happening down in South America. They're happening all around because business, baby. It's all about the almighty dollar.
One of those things that pissed me off so badly about, Sailor Chick was talking about Wilbur Ross. That sucker put his...
Mr. Magoo.
Yeah, but he put his profits above people's lives and got 12 West Virginia coal miners killed deader than Pharaoh's cat in the Sago mine.
Then tried to rationalize it. That fucker, you know.
Yeah, and now as Secretary of Commerce, he's trying to save 4,000 coal jobs that will ultimately kill the coal miners who have them.
Well, now that's just besides the point. That's just the cost of doing business, Bob.
That's exactly
so what's a life here, a life there. So a little kid gets some lung disease.
Sooner or later, that adds up to some real damn money.
Yeah, well, you know. Sue me.
Jesus Christ, that's, we're all going to burn
it. You can replace life, but you can't replace money, folks, according to Wilbur.
Yeah, that's him.
What an evil old troll.
The only time I root for religion is when I want somebody to burn in hell.
Or have a lightning bolt strike him.
Yeah, right up the butt. I'm telling you. I'm telling you, people, it's the power of everything we talk about, whether it's fundraising for mountaintop removal legislation or just the midterms or the 2020 election or the shit that's going on. It's the people's voice out there, like on Bob's show here, that raise the issues to more and more people that get concerned. And that's how we move the line, baby. That's how we gain progress. It's only by the power of the people on this side, baby, because on the other side is nothing but big bucks and corporations.
And they got lots of money.
Empathy is not in their vocabulary, baby.
No.
We have a president don't even know what the inside of a grocery store looks like. He thinks you have to show an ID card for beans, you know.
Bob, I anticipate you will have to be schlepping to D.C., fairly soon here. Is that correct?
That's why we're doing this now, so that when we do get the word that we got to go, we can go. Because all told, there's going to be probably three or four trips. And since we have to stay in hotels, that gets expensive.
Costs money.
That's because the sad thing about everything that needs to be done. It is going to cost
money. Even if you're staying out in Manasses, you're still looking at $7,500 a night.
Yeah.
And then you've got the schlep down I-66 into town, and then you've got to park your car for the day at $24 a day. And then you got to take cabs in the metro and shit like that.
There's no easy way. I mean, you could go to Elkton, Maryland, and it would still, you would not.
Yeah, and I mean, I've ridden the metro a lot, and it's.
But the thing is, we have people willing to go do the work. We just need other people to fund that.
Here's how it plays out. If in a perfect world we had the ability to really do the work the way it needs to be done, we would have a fund set aside. And so when it was time to say, talk to congressional Democrats from Texas, well, I'd give you a call, John, and say, you know, we're going to have a plane ticket ready for you. And and if you want to, you'll go into the office with us because you'll give us local credibility. Or if it was time to talk to some reps from Southern California, I'd call Rick and I'd call Tracy, and I'd call
there you go.
And Northern California, Sparky
of that area,
right? And that's how you do it. I mean, Future Farmers of America and all these groups with enough money to burn a sopping wet herd of wet elephants do that. They'll have 1 week every year they call Lobby Week, and they bring 100 people and they split up and they absolutely blanket the halls of Congress and the Senate so that everybody knows they're there and everybody knows what their agenda is.
There you go. And that's the way we push shit through. That's the only way it gets done.
I remember one.
The rest of it is just all out here talking about it.
I remember
that
one.
That sounds like fun work, Bob.
Sometime.
I'll tell you the truth. It ain't fun.
It's hard, but it's fulfilling.
It's tedious, though.
It will grind you. It'll grind you to a damn nub.
But anything worthwhile, it's gonna be hard.
Yeah, you walk away with the
really believe in it, baby. You got your heart in it.
Exactly. You walk away with the satisfaction of knowing that you haven't just sat around, that you've tried to do something to make your country a better place.
There you go.
It's far from a fucking vacation, man. It's the antithesis of that, you know.
But I would enjoy that stuff.
I'm thinking Tahiti.
That'd be more fun than practicing law, as far as I'm concerned.
I love a good argument.
Well, you know, a proctological exam is more fun than practicing law, Rick.
Yeah, it's not saying much.
Bob, you're going to miss Louise Slaughter the next time you go.
Oh, that woman. Oh, what a marvel she was.
Oh, my goodness. And she was so accommodating and so receptive to anything.
Well, I'm hoping that some of the folks, for instance, our dear friend Tara, she is a constituent of Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez.
Oh, there you go.
And I think we've got some other.
I like that lady.
I do too. And I think we've got some other members of the Horn Family Community Congregation. And when the time comes, and, you know, the time's basically now, she's got an office and stuff. If you're in Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez's district, send them an email. Jingle them up and say, hey, I support the Green New Deal, and I want the Appalachian Community's Health Emergency Campaign to be on your radar and something you're serious about because Appalachia deserves better.
She just got put on some sort of oversight committee.
Yes, she did. And that is, and
there's another thing to consider. Their home offices haven't been set up yet because of the shutdown.
Right. And when you're a newbie like that, it takes the better part of a year just to get your feet under you. But I love her because I love her because she's found a way to live rent free inside the head of just about every Republican the blatherskate out there.
And what better location could you be in? When
well, I mean, if you're living rent free in Mark Levin's head, you're pretty much slumming it. But no,
creepy place in there, I'm sure.
Oh, you gotta go listen to him creeping on her. There's a clip of him, Mark Levin. John, I ran it last night on the program. I think she should probably go and get a restraining order. That dude is dude's gross.
Oh, yeah, man.
Say it up with her. Ain't it, I love it. I love it. Let him get ate up with her.
I mean, she's a freshman senator, and her name is in everybody's mouth. She must be doing something right.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. She can't even run for president yet. I mean, because she's too young. Wrap your head around that.
Well, that's what we need. That's how we got to the moon, baby. Progressive thinking. You know, it's a vision. You know.
Oh, before I forget.
Baby, I got high hopes. What's up, Dennis?
I posted a link earlier, and I didn't want to interrupt the conversation about it was from a Reddit post. I mean, I'm not sure about the truth of it, but it sounded like it was worth checking into. Somebody did their homework about the steel slats for the proposed wall. Only one steel mill in the States can produce it, and it's co-owned by Russian oligarch.
How about
Roman Abramov or something?
Yes. Yeah, I heard the same thing. The only company that has the facilities big enough to build those slats could benefit a Russian company. Ain't that
Dennis, I just posted it in the Skype room as well, in case anybody's interested.
Did anybody hear about something like 30 indictments sealed in the last couple of days?
That docket has been busy.
I believe it has been, baby. I think we're getting to see, fixing to see a whole shit show.
And see, it wasn't necessary to go after me at 5 o'clock in the morning.
Yeah, it was.
You know why it was? Because now Junior is shitting kittens with crocheted tails.
I love
wondering
it.
If they're going to come through his door at 6 o'clock in the morning.
I can't wait for that. I want a member of his family because you know they're involved deeply in this shit. I want Junior. I want Ivanka. Eric, he's always chewing bubble gum, so you can't really.
If your name is Trump.
You got it, baby. It means crap.
Yeah, precious Ivanka with all her new trademarks in China.
Let's see how much of that revenue she collects from jail.
Oh, and one thing, because I just mentioned it and moved on, because that's how you do mass shootings in America anymore. The guy who shot up the Florida SunTrust Bank in Sebring, Florida, killed 5 people. Yeah.
Stole a scooter and got tracked down by GPS.
All of them were women. He targeted women.
He had previously told the school that he was in police officers, I guess, that he had dreams about killing people. He had that was known in his school where he went, and if I'm not mistaken, it was known by the local police where he came from. He only had been moved down to Florida for about a year, I think they said, but he had talked about this killing. But he had a fascination with killing people. No problem getting a handgun and some bulletproof vest. He didn't go in there to rob that bank.
No, he went in there to murder women.
That's what it is. And while this president every day sits there and tries to convince you that the fear that you have comes from the southern border, comes from marauding gangs coming up over the border, is bullshit.
Women with duct tape in back seats, women with their electrical tape around their wrists and ankles.
On these big vehicles, like giant vehicles, they just barrel right through there.
He needs to stop watching bondage porn.
But you're right, Bob. It was another white guy with a gun. And when it comes
And then there was the other one they caught before he could kill anybody. Not too long back.
Just recently. That was about a week ago, wasn't it?
But he said he wanted to kill women because he couldn't get a date.
We're in strange times, man. We're in strange times. But what's the answer to that? Because they've already made it so where a person who has psychological disorder can still got by a gun. You can't take his gun right away. His Second Amendment right. He may be a little loco in head, but Jesus Christ, don't take his gun.
Well, Uncle John, the proverb, "May you live in interesting times," was not a blessing. It's actually a curse. It's a curse.
Nobody wants to live in interesting times. I'd rather it be boring as crap. Beautiful days, sunshine with butterflies and rainbows.
I long for the day when the news cycle was about the curvature of the president's penis,
those were the days.
Times they have a change.
Wait. Those were the days, my friend. We thought his penis would not bend.
Now they got a pill for that. I don't know if you watch the TV or not, but they do.
Yeah,
I'm sure. I have no doubt. They have a pill for everything, from the depths of your depression to the heights of your erection. Anything you want, baby, there's a pill for it.
And we pay more for it.
That's right. Big pharmaceutical, baby.
Because Merca.
Merca.
Because freedom.
That's right.
Go ahead, Bob. Do the thing.
I support the
truth. Greatest country in the history of the world on earth now, today, forever, in the universe, under God.
That's right. That's right.
You got to get your reverb back, brother.
Well, it's here. I can hear it. Y'all can't. I don't know why. Or I was told it doesn't go out over the street. I think it has something. I think the cat walked across the board again, frankly.
That damn cat. I'm telling you.
It may have something to do with the fact that my damned iPad's dead and I can't get into the interface.
Jumper cables, Bob. That's how I fix my iPad.
You've
got to hook up them jumper cables.
Yeah, where do you put the red cable?
That's when I was having a hard time, but I think it's over there where you put the the ground is anywhere. You can just clamp that right on the iPad. The positive, you have to stick it through it. I got a coat hanger for mine. You know where you plug it into charge?
Oh yeah, the lightning port. I bet there's some real lightning comes out of it then, isn't there?
Stick it right up in there, Bob. Don't worry, it'll work fine.
Yeah, I bet it will. I know just enough about electricity to know that I have no business fooling with it.
That's me.
Hey, Bob, I got a semi-serious question for you.
Okay, I'll work on a semi-serious answer.
We're in our serious mood here now.
How many people in this chat do you think the NSA has files on?
Well, let me see. There's Bob.
We know Agent Fred's been listening to me since 2005.
Rick, he's a lawyer, so they probably got his ass. Me, I'm a redneck down here in hell. They don't give a shit what I'm saying.
Yeah, but you've been on the program now, so you're kind of screwed, John.
That's right. You busted me, Bob. Now I got to worry about it now. That's right. Anybody on this program, probably.
If they're filling out dossiers, just get my last name right.
Well, what we usually do is we shame them, and we say, listen, we don't mind. We love America. And we don't mind y'all listening to the program, but Agent Fred, it'd be kind of nice if you dig down and help keep the damn thing on the air if you're going to listen to it every night.
That's right. Make a donation. Call in, man.
I got a candidate.
Operators are standing by. This is a free call.
I get that question. I get that question. People say, well, John, I swear, how does the Secret Service not come to see you? I'd be tickled to death. I'd claim it as a badge of honor if they came see me.
We use some fun language, but that's legal on the interweb tubes.
Yep. Yes, I believe it was still in the Constitution, I believe.
And I mean, you know, nobody's calling for anybody to have anything done ugly done to them. I mean, or painful, or even dangerous.
Not to make this about me, but I got a cannabis card, so I'm sure Agent Fred's got the dossier on me too.
Probably does, buddy.
Yeah,
you know,
I don't care.
Well, actually, the feds cannot use any budgetary dollars to enforce anti-marijuana laws as of the past two or three budgets. So I think you're in the clear, Steve.
So they say, Bob. Come on, you buying into that, really?
Oh, really? Do I have to do my Alex Jones voice and start selling the chocolate chicken bone paleo beverage?
You ain't got Alex Jones in your head, do you, Bob? Tell me it ain't so, Bob.
I absolutely have Alex Jones. You know what, John Britovo, you neoliberal establishment shill. Don't you realize that in Hong Kong they'll sell you a monkey jellyfish hybrid? They will. And they bring them to America and they use them to turn our children gay.
The frogs are gay already.
How do you think they got that way? They dropped a jellyfish monkey hybrid on them, and you know how those monkeys are.
They screwed the place. Bob, I'm concerned about your psychic, man. I'm concerned about your head, buddy. If you got that guy running around in your head.
Oh no! You don't want to know the dreams I have, dude. You just don't want to know. They're vivid. It's like watching a goddamn movie. There are mornings I wake up and I look at Agnes and she said, "How was your night?" And I mean, you're here, so it was pretty good. But I really didn't get any rest because I was at the mind movies all night.
Man, I'm telling you,
I had a dream the other night. I was invaded by Amish people.
Well, to quote Bob Dylan, he once said in one of his songs, if my thought dreams could be seen, they'd probably put my head in the guillotine.
There you go. There you go. I like to quote Andy Garcia.
Yep.
The truth is what you find on your way to someplace else.
There we go.
I always like
that. Or that great Canadian folk singer whose name, Bruce, somebody, come on, Canada contingent, help me out here. Who simply said, life short, act now.
Act now, baby. You ain't got no more time. See, that's how come I started opening my mouth. I'm running out of time, baby. I thought, when is it going to be my
Bruce,
time?
Bruce Coburn? Something? Bruce Coburn?
Not ringing a bell.
Nope. I do have a Canadian singer CD, but he's a bit country, and I can't remember a single song, but I used to sing a lot of him. Canadian friend sent me some music. Something I can't even think of right now.
I don't know if you pronounce it Cockburn or Coburn, but it's C-O-C-K-B-U-R-N, and his first name's Bruce. And it's the title of and the line in the song, Life Short, Act Now.
That's it, buddy. Ain't gonna be no other time but now. And now is the most important time.
This ain't no dress rehearsal.
Mm-mm. You get one shot at this shit. And, you know, just celebrating a birthday, like I said, I'm tickled to death I made it this far, because there's times in my life I didn't think I was and didn't give a shit. Now I do. So now I'm hanging around. I got something to say. So,
well, Uncle John, I'm
yeah, you
kind of want to
see how
brother.
It plays out, don't Thank you, John?
Yeah, I want to see how this all ends. You know, I done stuck my foot in this shit. I want to make sure I get it all wiped off.
I really would like to see our country return to some semblance of normalcy.
Before I check out, yeah.
Do you remember how boring the Obama administration was? The only thing, you know, he was unflappable, and the worst thing about it was the Republican Congress they had to cope with, and the racists and the newspapers.
Oh, I long for those
drawing editorial cartoons comparing him to a monkey. And still, you know, just cool.
That's
cool,
what he
cool.
was.
And somewhere out there, is Bob's neoliberal fucking shill. Neoliberal establishment shill. Obama was just another kind of Republican. He was not the progressive purity sparkle pony that I necessarily wanted. But sometimes stability has its own value.
Yes. We can go back even further. How about reliving the lives of the Carter administration?
We've been divided before politically. We've had our differences, but it has never gone to the depth that this is because of this man, because of Donald.
Right.
Well, see, I mean, even when this country was bitterly divided over Vietnam, that was pretty much a single issue. And you remember it, John, you remember it, Sparky. But there were pretty, this ain't that. This is just people saying, I'm sick of the other two-thirds of the country that doesn't think like me. And why y'all got to be so mean about me wanting to wear my clan hood?
Well, that's what it is. That's what he has brought back to this country. It never went away. It just went under the covers. It hid because there was no tolerance for it. But now with Donnie up in here, oh shit, Jeff.
Well, yeah, exactly. And see, that's the thing. You know, when America sneezes, the world gets the flu. So, in Germany, for instance, it is illegal to give the Nazi salute. It's illegal to wave the Nazi flag. It's illegal to be a Nazi. Okay?
Well,
it is not, it is not illegal to be a member of the Klan. So guess what's growing in Germany right now?
Yep.
That's right, the Klan. And so since they can't fly the Hakenkreuz flag, guess what they fly?
Oh, Lord, please.
The Confederate battle flag. And they're marching around in white robes. The Klan of Greater Germany.
Given power by the man that took our house. That's where they got the power for. That's where they're empowered.
You know, I remember when Julius Geezer gave a speech in Poland, and all those Poles were back there waving Confederate battle flags.
Oh, yeah.
They knew what it means, even if Cletus, even if Cletus Stumplick doesn't.
And that's how come the voice, your voice, Bob, and I know you have fans all around the world. I know I have family members that we have all around the world. It's not only here in America. We have to stop that shit no matter where you find it.
Well,
so there are people in different countries all around this world that are standing up against it because it is showing its ugly head. And it was.
And because if it is allowed to take root and grow, the next one is going to make what happened between 1939 and 1945 look like child's play.
And we cannot allow that to happen.
Yeah, the fascists weren't defeated in World War II. They just moved to South America and America. That's all that happened.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And now they're spreading back, you know, some of them are, I mean, Europe is, Italy's got a leader or wannabe leader who's like, very much like a Trump.
I saw a photograph the other day of a journalist in Greece who had had the shit beaten out of him by the fascist Golden Dawn assholes over there.
Oh, God.
See? It's not just here.
No.
This shit has gained a breath from this man.
It's
because if they can do it in America, they can do it anywhere.
This is kind of a weird story, and we got to get out of here. But I ran across a story out of Japan. A case went to the Supreme Court of Japan, brought by a transgender person, on a law that the Japanese have that requires that that before a person can have corrective gender surgery, they must first be sterilized. And the Supreme Court of Japan said, "Yep." That's what it says. That's what you got to do. And that's a manifestation of fascist thinking.
I like our side, Bob. I don't believe in asterisks.
Nope,
I don't like asterisks.
I don't like them either. Don't like them at all.
Nope.
Well, y'all, I thank you a bunch. John, I hope you have a good weekend. I hope you have a good weekend, Steve. And Billable Rick, enjoy the concert. Thank you for the challenge. That finished things off. Thank you so much. Thank you to Dennis there in San Antonio. Thank you. Let's see, did I miss anybody?
Oh, man.
Thank you to Sparky for moderating this evening.
I was sitting here talking to you, and I just looked down and noticed I was muted, buddy.
No, you weren't.
No, I just muted you for
okay. I'll mute myself again then.
So thank you, Sparky, and thanks to everybody who hangs out for this little ongoing conversation over the course of the years. Thank you to all of you who keep the program going. Thanks for helping us finish January. The rest of the month, four whole days, is fundraising free radio. Thank you to our all-volunteer staff in the chat room, Sparky and Steve. Thank you to our news ninjas. Thank you to Brother Deacon Asa, headon.live. Thanks very kindly to John Fox in Australia. Thank you, Ben Birch, whiterosesociety.org. And thanks to the hardest working, bravest people I know, the men and women of Coal River Mountain Watch, crmw.net. And always, 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 Gina, it's all for you. Later, y'all. Have a great weekend.